June 22nd, 2016. Tomorrow is going to be the vote as to whether or not Britain will leave the European Union. And of course, this has global consequences, not only directly in Europe. And of course, the European Union could start to unravel. And that would be, I think, a very good thing, because the European Union is now trying to consolidate with the essentially the North American Union. It's always economic consolidation first, and then closely followed by political consolidation. People in Europe have had enough of it. People across Europe have had enough of it. So they're starting to break out of that confinement. So we're going to be talking to Lord Monckton, because the referendum is tomorrow and all eyes are on Britain. Today, as we just before we went on air, we had Donald Trump start to essentially define Hillary Clinton. And so we're going to have a lot of breakdown of that speech. We've got an article that's up on the Drudge Report from InfoWars. Trump says Hillary makes millions from anti-gay, anti-woman regimes and wants Sharia migrants. And we're going to break down what that looks like for you in Saudi Arabia. You know, Hillary says she's a woman. Vote for her because she's a woman. Vote for her because she's going to do things for women. And yet she takes all of this money from these oppressive regimes throughout the Middle East, like Saudi Arabia. We're going to share a story with you about what the women in Saudi Arabia do on bumper car night. You won't believe this, how desperate they are to have a little bit of freedom and independence, to get the burqa off, to be able to drive a car. They're not interested in bumping into each other. They just want to be able to drive a car a little bit, have a little bit of freedom. So we're going to share that with you. Meanwhile, today, Hillary Clinton is in North Carolina. You know, we constantly hear about how Donald Trump is just poison for the GOP. He hurts the GOP so much. Really? You know, he brought in record numbers of voters this last election. Of course, Hillary's vote totals crashed from 8 years ago when she last ran for president. Hillary is being shunned in North Carolina by the top of the ticket of the Democrat Party. She's going to be talking in Raleigh today, and yet the candidate for governor is not going to be there. The candidate for Senate is not going to be there. What does that tell you about that important swing state, North Carolina? Is one of the swing states that is a must-win. There's a lot of reliable states that are going to go for the GOP, a lot of reliable states that are going to go for the Democrats. North Carolina is one of the states that is in swing, and the Democrats there do not want to be associated with her. It would be very bad timing, especially today, the way Donald Trump came out against Hillary Clinton. And as I pointed out, we're going to break that down a great deal for you. Also, Bill O'Reilly, you missed this yesterday, he's calling for gun registration. Here's an article from the Independent Sentinel. Bill O'Reilly wants assault weapons banned. He wants gun registered the same way that we register cars. He's also naive enough to think no one really wants to disarm Americans. And they point out, you know, we've been targeted by the IRS. Why would we want to create yet another thing where we're registered? I have to say, you know, you always use, isn't it interesting? When we had Obamacare, they said, well, we got mandatory insurance for cars. Now they're saying we had mandatory registration for cars. We have all kinds of arbitrary regulations for cars that infringe on our freedom to travel. So why can't we infringe on the rest of our freedoms? That's why I say, you know, all of our rights hang together, or we lose all of our rights at the same time. And I think it's time that we not only reject this idea that we're going to enact controls because we've already put them on our transportation. I think we need to start liberating freedom of movement within this country. I think we need to start looking at things that we have given up that are fundamental rights, the rights to move about freely, the rights to travel. And I think we need to stop making those privileges. But of course, Bill O'Reilly and the people who want big government always use cars and airports as the template for how they're going to take more of our freedoms. And they also point out in this that Hillary is now talking about not assault rifles, but assault pistols. What does that mean? You know, an assault rifle is not defined. Even the liberal papers admit that. It's simply something that they want to make you afraid about. Stay with us when we come back. Alex Jones is going to join us from the road and give us his perspective. We'll be right back.
People talk a lot about being awake. But what does that really mean? The entire modern political system, the entire modern media system, is about putting you into a controlled paradigm of limited information. And all of the major markers show that IQs are dropping. Cognitive ability is imploding. People are becoming more and more ignorant, more and more shuttered, more and more on a psychological and spiritual reservation. To be free, I'm not saying you have to believe what Alex Jones believes. I'm simply saying you have to get outside that controlled reservation of globalist social engineering and think for yourself and realize there's a wider universe of mystery and majesty all around us. And that as long as we stand for individual freedom, as long as we stand for the individual to be able to try to live out their own destiny, we are brothers and sisters no matter what color we are or what region of the world we come from. That truly unifies us. The globalists are trying to create an artificial construct where they unify us around the idea of a central control system where we don't criticize anybody or we don't have any basic free will, and we take the central directives from a planned economy, a planned computer-driven system to decide what jobs we have or where we go to school or where we travel or what we have for dinner. They're selling collectivism as the idea of giving up our individuality. That's counterfeit collectivism. True collectivism in the human sense is totally individual and totally independent and absolutely democratic. Democracies in a mass sense are very dangerous. You can get 51% to vote to make the other 49% slaves. That's why in a republic, basic liberties of all, including the minority, are protected. But in a democracy of the free market, where you vote for the music you like by what you listen to and what you support, where you vote for the food you like by what you buy and what you promote, where you vote for the education you like by where you send your children or where you go for secondary education. That is the true diversity. That is the true unifier. And we've seen in the last few weeks tragic Islamic attacks in Europe and the Middle East and also here in the United States on lesbians and gays and others. And it's really been a big wake-up call for these people that believe the state cares about them to understand that this state and other states have brought in these radical Islamics because they're more compatible with what the globalists want to build than an open, free society. And to see gun shops all over the United States, like right here in Texas, in Houston, offering people free shooting lessons and free training, reaching out to them and saying, gun owners don't hate you. Gun owners, on average, aren't bigots. Gun owners want you as a human to be able to protect yourself and even the odds when some monstrous killer comes in to take your lives and others. That's what it's all about. That's why guns are this great equalizer. It's why the establishment pushes to take guns from the general population because they want to be the only ones with the guns. And I know that's incredibly simple, but it's true. Every other nation on earth, except for a few like Switzerland, have taken the guns from their people, and they're all moving steadily into corruption, into authoritarianism. The few nations that haven't taken the guns, like Switzerland, have the lowest crime rates in the world, the highest standards of living, because they're truly citizens. They're truly trusted by the state. The people are the state, and so they are empowered. They have choices. They have great freedom. They have lower taxes because... because, ladies and gentlemen, they are the state. We need a small state because we need to have the manifestation of our individual will through a collective be minimized because historically it's so incredibly dangerous. But that's because that's collectivism centralized and focused like a laser. It can be destructive. But when true individually expressed collectivism, these are my own views, but everyone sees them as evident of truth because they're universal, they're obvious truth, prima facie. When individuals make choices, that is the crowdsourcing of common sense, and that is the ultimate in the expression of free will by individuals, but in a collective spectrum that truly brings us the Renaissance and the huge palette of choices we have today. Let's continue to discuss the nature of the world and how to truly break the matrix and become free. And again, I don't have all the answers, my friends. I simply understand basic universal truths throughout time immemorial that have empowered and unleashed the true potential of humanity.
Okay, and that's Alex Jones on the road, and he's going to be joining us with a special report at the bottom of the hour as well. Now, the top stories that are breaking today are the major speech by Donald Trump defining Hillary. And we have a report from the road about Hillary for prison. Actually, Slate Magazine wrote a story about a person at the Donald Trump rally in Las Vegas on Saturday and spent a great deal of time talking about her Hillary for Prison t-shirt. And that was the title of the article. We're going to tell you about that. But also, We're going to have Lord Monckton joining us in the second hour. We're going to be talking about Brexit. All eyes internationally are on Brexit. Look, you have to understand, the election that we have here in America with Donald Trump, as well as Brexit, they're all about the same issue. We just had the first female mayor of Rome elected. And a lot of people focus on the fact in the mainstream media, oh, first female mayor of Rome. No, the real story is that she's a populist mayor, that she is against the consolidation of power into the EU. Now, they can't portray her as a far-right extremist because she's not. She's a lefty environmentalist. And so they kind of, many of them don't even want to talk about her politics. They just talk about the fact that she's female. But it's very important because that is another example of how people across the political spectrum want to take back control of their lives locally instead of surrendering it to a distant bureaucracy. So we're going to be talking to Lord Monckton about what's going on in Brexit because it affects all of us. There is a globalist consolidation that's going on, a consolidation of power. And the question is Britain going to remain a nation or is it going to be subsumed into this collective globalist Borg? And the same thing is true of America. Is America going to remain a nation or are we going to lose our sovereignty? Because that's what's going to happen if the Trans-Pacific, Transatlantic partnerships happen. Our trade, our economy is going to be managed by a committee that we have absolutely no control over. There's no election of this committee. And they can rewrite the terms of that agreement, which will rewrite the terms of our economy at will. Senator Sessions, who many of us believe, I hope that Donald Trump will pick him as vice president, has laid that out. He says it's a living document. You don't know what this thing is going to become once you've passed it. But let's take a look real quickly at some of the first snippets of what Donald Trump is saying about Hillary Clinton today. We have an article that's up on the Drudge Report. Kit Daniels, Trump says Hillary takes millions from anti-gay, anti-woman regimes, and she wants Sharia migrants. He points out Hillary Clinton takes millions of dollars from these regimes in the Middle East. He says, I only want to admit people who share our values, who love our people. But Hillary Clinton wants to bring in people who believe women should be enslaved and that gays should be put to death. He says the government of Brunei also stands to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of Hillary's Trans-Pacific Partnership, which she would absolutely approve if given the chance. Absolutely. That's why the establishment and both parties support Hillary. This election is about the consolidation of globalist power. And she is the one who will give it to them. Donald Trump is the one who stands in their way, just like Brexit. That's why we've got all of the corporations, all the political establishment. Obama was in Britain stumping against Brexit to keep them in the European Union. Trump says Hillary Clinton took up to $25 million from Saudi Arabia, where being gay is also punishable by death. They bragged that they gave her 20% of what she took in. Now, take a look at this Wall Street Journal article, for example. This is an article about Saudi Arabian women who love to ride bumper cars. Now, they don't do it because they get a kick out of bumping each other. They do it because they're so desperate for a little taste of freedom. Look at that picture. Two women in a burqa sitting in a bumper car. And that's the only time they can get behind the wheel in that oppressive regime. Do you think they got a bumper sticker on that bumper car that says, I'm for Hillary, I'm with her? I don't think so. I don't think so. Bumper burkas, I guess you could call the ride. I don't know. But you know what? Donald Trump had a great line in his speech. Look at that picture, that illustration. That is priceless. A woman in a burqa, that's a Wall Street Journal, typical kind of a woodcut illustration with a woman in a burqa sitting in a bumper car. You know, her slogan, I'm with her. Donald Trump says, you know what? I'm with you. I support you. I'm not asking you to get behind me and make me an emperor, okay? Like Hillary Clinton is. Now listen to what happens in Saudi Arabia. This is important. Here's a woman, they're talking about how she drove in circles and when the cars came in her direction, she swerved. These were electric bumper cars, but in Saudi Arabia, the ride doesn't always live up to his name. She says, I come here to drive. She's a 27-year-old homemaker. She's still giddy from the roughly 5-minute, mostly crash-free ride in her red and green two-seater. She says it's much better than bumping against others. This is at a weekly ladies' night only, where women can discard their headscarves and their head-to-toe black gowns to reveal the latest fashion trends, ripped jeans, tank tops, tossed to the side, 80s-style hair. Now, there's no men at all in the park on this night. all the women are, all the entire amusement park is run by women staff. They said the biggest draw of the amusement park isn't the new hours, however, of fashion freedom. Instead, they go there to get behind the wheel. Even a bumper car wheel in a country that bans female drivers. There's no loud bangs, no ferocious head-on crashes. There's a few slow speed collisions, but also a lot of women who are dodging, as women are content to just glide over the smooth surface with a little tiny steering wheel in their hand. Isn't that sad? Are we going to be like that when the driverless cars take over? Are we going to be that repressed? But this is what's going on here. They say they love to drive the cars. And when the men come here, they're always bumping. But if you bump the ladies, they scream at you and say, hey, I came here to drive. Stop that. And then the night is over. And they have to walk out and put on their hoods. And the men pick them up. Because the religious police in Saudi Arabia, the supporters that Hillary Clinton prostitutes herself for, will arrest them, will beat them. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Wednesday, June 22nd, 2016. Of course, the big issues before us today are another attempt at gun control coming from the Senate. We have a major policy speech. I would put it that way. It's talking about Hillary Clinton. But, you know, folks, if you're a criminal and a liar, that's been her policy. OK, so he's defining her policy by defining her. And then we're also going to have Lord Monckton joining us in the second hour, in the next hour, to talk about Brexit, which is the vote is going to happen tomorrow. And that's a global issue. We've talked about that just a moment ago. But I want to talk about the story from Slate. Now, last Saturday, Donald Trump was in Las Vegas. And Slate wrote an article that just came out. And the title of the article was Hillary for Prison 2016. And it's like, whoa, that's like our T-shirt. And it's like, yeah, it's exactly like our T-shirt. The whole article, the beginning of the article, is about our T-shirt. And they talked to a lady, Anna, and I believe her name is pronounced Kate. It's K-H-A-I-T. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing it. Anna Kate, a 27-year-old professional poker player and a contestant on the latest season of Survivor, was standing next to the entrance of the Cirque du Soleil's Mystery in the Treasure Island Hotel, explaining the shirt she was wearing, and it read Hillary for Prison 2016. She says, I got this on Infowars.com. I love this shirt, she said. There's so many people walking by and saying, I love this shirt. I love this shirt. Give me a high five. At this moment, a middle-aged black woman stopped to compliment Kate on her shirt. Yay, Hillary. For prison, Kate explained gently. Oh, you want her in prison? The woman asked. She's a criminal, Kate replied. And if you want to have a conversation starter like this lady that they were talking about, you can get your Hillary for Prison T-shirt at InfoWars. We've even got a special on it, a limited special, 50% off for 1 week. And it's started yesterday, so it's not that long. And get the next one for 75% off, 50% off the first one, 75% off the second one. And as you heard, it looks like Hillary for president, because the lady who walked by thought that's what it was, said, yay, Hillary. But if you look closely, it says Hillary for prison. And that's precisely where she needs to be, in the big house, not the White House. Okay, now, Donald Trump is out saying that Hillary is a world-class liar. Let's play this clip from today's speech.
Hillary Clinton, and as you know, she, most people know, she's a world-class liar. Just look at her pathetic email server statements or her phony landing. Or her phony landing in Bosnia, where she said she was under attack, and the attack turned out to be young girls handing her flowers. A total and look, this was yeah, one of the buttes.
Okay.
A total and self-serving lie.
So is he overstepping this? Is he going a little bit too far, calling her a world-class liar? Let's fact-check that. Let's play the clip from CBS News when she was in Bosnia. Here's that clip.
There was supposed to be some kind of a greeting ceremony at the airport, but instead we just ran with our heads down to get into the vehicles to get to our base.
Problem is, that's not what happened. And we should know, CBS News accompanied the First Lady and daughter Chelsea on that Bosnia trip. That's Senator Clinton talking to me on the military flight into Tuzla. And these are the pictures we recorded of the greeting ceremony when the plane landed. Compare that to Senator Clinton's account.
I remember landing under sniper fire. There was no greeting ceremony. And we basically were told to run to our cars. Now that is what happened.
Thank you.
Getting kisses from little girls.
There was no sniper fire either when Senator Clinton visited two Army outposts where she posed for photos. And no sniper fire back at the base.
Last night I had...
where she sang at a USO show starring Sinbad and Sheryl Crow.
Yeah, she's a world-class liar. No doubt about it. Okay, here's some of the other things that Donald Trump said. He said her server, of course, that's what he was just talking about. He goes, she's lying about this server thing. He said her server was easily hacked by foreign governments, perhaps even by her financial backers in communist China, putting all of America in danger. Then he went on to say, you know, I don't know what's in those deleted emails, but our enemies probably do. Oh, no, it's not a probably. He soft-sold that. It's a definitely. Our enemies definitely know what's in that. Look, if Guccifer could hack into these private servers, and the guy is not even an IT specialist, he just guessed at their passwords, okay? You can bet that the private server of the Secretary of State is a target. We've had the Federal Reserve hacked 50 different times because they want to know what the private discussions of the Federal Reserve are. You think they'd want to know what the State Department's talking about? He says, yeah, they probably have a blackmail file over someone who wants to be president of the United States. Exactly. Stay with us when we come back. Alex Jones will be joining us.
This is what the establishment media does, attempting to totally control the narrative of our lives. They tell us that Obamacare does not have death panels, even though they admit now it does. They tell us Obamacare is free. Then it cuts your bill in half. Then it's the cost of a phone or cable bill. Then you can keep your doctor. And then, of course, we have one of the architects of it, Gruber, on C-SPAN saying, thank God the American people are so stupid and don't have attention spans. And then he says that he never said that. And seven more videos at least come out of him bragging about developing the deceptive plan to be used against the American people. And it's that same tactic we see out of Slate magazine with their latest headline. And Slate magazine comes out with this demonization campaign and says, oh my gosh, you know, the incredible conspiracy theory from Alex Jones that Hillary needs to go to prison. The idea that she's committed any crimes, the idea that she should be prosecuted, it's as asinine as saying that maybe Richard Nixon should be prosecuted, except Richard Nixon did nothing compared to her. But they sit there and they shake their fingers at us and they make fun of us and they just imply that none of this is happening, hoping that the most dumbed down elements of society out there don't actually look into the facts. But I mean, just imagine this now. It's now conspiracy theory. If you wear a t-shirt that says Hillary for president 2016, obviously a pun saying instead of being in the Oval Office, she needs to, you know, be in the reopened Alcatraz. So this is how they manipulate society. This is how they manipulate culture. And it's totally and completely sick. And that's why I'm intensifying my efforts. They're really upset about this meme. They see it at Donald Trump rallies, but other rallies all over the country. There are hundreds of other t-shirt shops and things online now imitating the shirt or making variants of it. Personally, I'm totally fine with that because I wanted this to be a meme that was picked up by the American people. I wanted this to be a meme that went completely viral and showed the power. It's not about selling t-shirts for $19.95. But speaking of the devil, they're $9.95 right now for the first shirt you get. The second shirt you get in the same order is $4.95. That is 75% off, ladies and gentlemen. 75% off. And imagine the power. If tens of thousands more of these shirts go out, imagine the power of those being seen at events all over the country, all over.
over television, really breaking the Berlin Wall of control and saying to the social engineers, yes, we want Hillary Clinton to go to prison. Yes, we want her investigated for Benghazi and back to the Cattlegate futures and Vince Foster and Fast and Furious and her foundation and everything this criminal administration and this group of mafias are involved in. So that's what it comes down to. That's what we the people want. It's what common sense shows. And the attempt by the social engineers to pull this operation off, the attempt by the globalists to sit there and make us feel like we're weird, we're alone, we're strange, and that it's bizarre to actually call for these criminals to get in trouble is just asinine. Their hoax is falling. Their attempt to control reality is just dissipating. And the only facade left is that free thinkers still think that we're somewhat alone and don't realize the real power we have. And it is something like a Molon Labe shirt or a Come and Take It shirt or a Hillary for Prison shirt from InfoWarsStore.com that A, funds the InfoWar with the latest info, but B, allows the public to really interface with each other and realize how many of us there really are. And so that we can have our own narrative, we can challenge their false reality and bring in common sense. So I want to challenge folks to take advantage of the 75% off. You can go to InfoWars.com/show. And you can also find links right there to the newsletter, InfoWars.com/newsletter. But both of those pages have links to each other. Put in your email and we'll send you a promo code for 75% off the second shirt, 50% off the first shirt. And again, we're not really making a profit off this, but it's all about just getting the word out and really rubbing salt in the wound, because this meme has them scared. This meme absolutely is symbolic of the villagers coming with their pitchforks, coming with their hatchets towards the castle. And the social engineers are absolutely aware of the fact that the media has a 6% trust rate in a major national AP poll. They know the Congress has a 9% approval rating in Gallup poll. They know they're a pack of criminals. They know they're a pack of scum. They know they've committed crimes so great that they've doubled and tripled down all the way to the next level, and that they're trying to fail forward. She needs to get into the presidency to cover up her past crimes and persecute her enemies. So we are full steam ahead exposing this. Hillary for President 2016 and Slate and all the other establishment publications. The New York Times has talked about it. They all show their weakness when they sit there and demonize this, when they sit there and try to shut this down, because they know it's having a giant effect. Now back to David Knight, Paul Watson, and others that are co-hosting this live Global Wednesday transmission.
Thank you, Alex. That's Alex Jones. And of course, today is a major speech from Donald Trump. You remember a couple of weeks ago, he said, I'm going to have a major speech on Monday. I'm going to define Hillary. And of course, that didn't happen because we had the Orlando shooting stories that came out over that weekend. And so here we are about 10 days after that, and the speech has come out, and it is a major speech. He hit her with everything, essentially. But he starts out by talking about the economy. That is a key issue, folks. People vote their pocketbook. It's the economy, stupid. That's what the Clinton campaign said when they won. And, of course, that is a very powerful weapon for Donald Trump, and it is something most people believe, rightfully so, that he can do a far better job than Hillary Clinton of relieving us of the burdens that the federal government has put on us. And one of the things he says is, of course, he's going to change immigration rules to give unemployed Americans opportunities to get good jobs. He stands to, he vows to stand up for countries that cheat on U.S. trade. And we need to understand, folks, when you bring in workers, when you export jobs, when you say, as Hillary Clinton does, she's going to give blanket amnesty to people, and yet look at the massive numbers of people. Even the Federal Reserve is saying the unemployment numbers are totally bogus. They don't include people who have given up looking for work or who haven't been able to find a job for a very long time. They just exclude them. When did that kind of phony accounting begin in the economy? Well, you can go back to the first Clinton administration. That's when they started doing that. And then he talks about the open borders. And of course, really, folks, it's not gun control, it's border control. If you want to talk about things that are endangering us here, he says Hillary Clinton, who already has the blood of so many on her hands, is now announcing she is willing to put each and every one of our lives in harm's way. An open door policy to criminals, to terrorists who enter our country. Hillary is not concerned about you or I. Because, you know, quite frankly, All of these gun control measures, they keep screaming, background checks, watch lists. I want to watch these people. I want to know what they're doing. I want to know who they are. Well, they didn't do it for this Orlando shooter, did they? Okay. And they're not doing it for the people coming into this country. They have no idea who these people are. So don't talk to us about having background checks once the people get into this country. It's a bit late at that point. Let's play a clip from Donald Trump's speech where he's talking about Hillary taking money from the Arab countries and her email scandal.
Hillary Clinton accepted $58,000 in jewelry from the government of Brunei when she was Secretary of State, plus millions more for her foundation. The Sultan of Brunei has pushed oppressive Sharia law, including the punishment by death and stoning if you happen to be gay. The government of Brunei also stands to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of Hillary's Trans-Pacific Partnership, which she would absolutely approve if given the chance. Hillary Clinton's book, and just think of this, the book talks about it, but Hillary took $25 million from Saudi Arabia and much more from others, where being gay is also punishable by death. Hillary took millions from Kuwait, Qatar, Oman, and many other countries that horribly abuse women and the LGBT citizens. To cover up her corrupt dealings, Hillary illegally stashed her State Department emails on a private server. She's under investigation, but it seems like nothing's going to happen, even though other people who have done similar things, but much at a much lower level, their lives have been destroyed. It's a rigged system, folks. It's a rigged system. Her server was easily hacked by foreign governments, perhaps even by her financial backers in communist China. Sure they have it. Putting all of America and our citizens in danger, great danger. Then there are the 33,000 emails she deleted. Well, we may not know what's in those deleted emails. Our enemies probably know every single one of them. So they probably now have a blackmail file over someone who wants to be the president of the United States. This fact alone disqualifies her from the presidency. We can't hand over our government to someone whose deepest, darkest secrets may be in the hands of our enemies. You can't do it.
Not only does it disqualify her, but we need to understand that this government, this administration, the Obama administration, has used the Espionage Act of 1917 more than against journalists and against whistleblowers, more than all of the presidents combined in the previous 100 years. Think about that. Think about that. Think about how vigorous they have been to shut down all transparency in our government from whistleblowers, from journalists, calling them spies because they worship national security. And then look at the free pass that Hillary Clinton gets. Can she preside in this ridiculous hypocrisy over this aggressive and over-the-top national security state? Of course she can't. Of course she can't. And I would hope that Donald Trump would scale it back, but I don't see any signs that he will. There are other reasons to vote for Donald Trump. I don't think he's going to pull back the national security state. But when you look at what the Obama administration that she was a part of did to people like Thomas Drake and the whistleblowers, William Binney from the NSA, who tried to warn us about the dragnet surveillance that now everybody understands and believes because of the Snowden leaks. When you look at how they came after Thomas Drake, and I've interviewed him, they came after him and went over him with a fine-tooth comb to try to find something that they could come against him with very serious charges. And what they found were some training manuals, you know, security is our friend and that type of thing, and tried to send him to jail for that. And here we've got Hillary Clinton with some of the most beyond top secret documents you can have, private discussions with foreign heads of state, completely in violation of the security agreements, what she understands as a Secretary of State. She signed documents saying that she would abide by the laws and regulations of the national security state, and they prosecute people for whistleblowing, and yet she walks free and clear. And then, as Donald Trump pointed out, a friend to the most oppressive regimes in the world. Oppressive to the people that she appeals to vote for her because of her identity. She says, vote for me, LGBT people, because I'm one of you. Vote for me because I'm a woman. And yet, look at Saudi Arabia. I read earlier that story from the Wall Street Journal talking about these Saudi Arabian women who long for the one night a week in the capital, Jeddah, where they can go to an amusement park and sit in bumper cars, not so that they can play bumper cars, but so they can actually feel what it's like to drive a car. Now, they go on to say, in a country where 23% of Saudi women, only 23%, have jobs, ladies-only nights bring women out in force. Every employee there is, in fact, a woman because, you know, they have this rigid segregation of sexes. And it's only because they only have all the employees as women that they're allowed to take off the burqas and the beekeeper suits. Okay, everyone from popcorn sellers to the security guards to the bumper car attendant, the men have the night off. And while cinemas are normally banned in Saudi Arabia, there are two of them in this amusement park. Granted, the movies last under 5 minutes, and the experience is really just about the special effects. It's got 3D screens, seats that jolt you around and spray water on you, okay? But for them, the biggest attraction is the fact that they can ride in these cars and that they don't have to be hassled by the men. The men who have been trained by this culture, by this religion, to oppress and harass women. The men who send the money to Hillary Clinton. And then they go on to say, the way they end the story is they say, many of the female bumper car drivers confide that they would really like to sit in the driver's seat outside of the park's walls. Some of them say that they secretly they have. And then this woman who they talk to, and I hope the Saudi religious police don't read the Wall Street Journal, because if they do, she and her husband are big trouble. She says with pride, I've driven in the desert. Yeah, yeah. If you're in Saudi Arabia, you can drive in the desert, maybe. Okay, those are the people that we have been so closely allied to. And it's not just the Clintons, okay? It's the establishment, Republican and Democrat. Remember, it was Henry Kissinger. All these people who are pushing these globalist trade deals on us, they are the ones who took us off the gold standard. Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger, they created the alliance with the Saudis where all oil would be sold in the dollar. They would create the petrodollar. They would buy our treasury bills. And then when we have a classified document, the government's own conspiracy theory, the official 9/11 report that has 28 pages where they talked about the Saudis, and somebody said, wait a minute, you can't say that about our guys because, I mean, they're locked hip and thigh with the CIA. They redacted that. And if that were to come out, people would sue them. And they actually started running bills to the Senate to allow the Saudis to be sued. And the Saudis said, you do that, we're going to dump $750 billion of your treasury bills, blackmailing us. Those are our closest allies. Those are the close supporters of Hillary Clinton, the people who brag that they gave her 20% of her financing. Those people who are so closely tied to the CIA. And of course, as Paul Craig Roberts pointed out, when we talk about the Brexit vote that is coming up tomorrow, as he pointed out, the European Union is a creation of the CIA. They wanted a single point of control. So they're intimately involved in the creation of the European Union. Obama and the establishment, both Republican and Democrat, do not want to see Britain leave the EU. They want Britain to be controlled. They want Britain to be subsumed. They do not want them to leave the European Union reservation. That vote is tomorrow. Coming up in the next hour, we're going to be talking to Lord Monckton, and he's going to explain to us what is at stake, because this is something that affects us all. We're in a war right now about global consolidation that will wipe out the nation states of the West. Brexit is a part of it. Donald Trump is a part of it. You can be a part of it. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Wednesday, June 22nd, 2016, the day before Brexit. As I point out, we're going to be talking to Lord Monckton about that in the next hour. I've got a speech coming up. I want you to hear from Boris Johnson, the former mayor of London. And he lays out what is truly at stake here. We hear all this talk about all the different economic measures. Are they going to be better off economically? And certainly you can take a look and you can understand and you can get a dollar figure as to how much they are sending to the European Union as a net loss. And then they reply and say, yeah, but we're part of this great big trading bloc, and we really don't know what's going to happen if the trade deals change. So they have specific metrics that show this massive bleeding of cash coming out. And then the other side that says remain in it because we don't really know what will happen if we get out of it. That's what we're seeing played back and forth. But it is truly about sovereignty. And I want to play you this clip from Boris Johnson where he talks about this and he lays this out. They had a debate last night and they had people from both sides talking. This is his summary speech. It's a great speech.
At the end of this campaign, I think you'll agree, there is a very clear choice between those on their side who speak of nothing but fear of the consequences of leaving the EU, and we on our side who offer hope. Between those who have been endlessly rubbishing our country and running it down, and those of us who believe in Britain. They say we can't do it. We say we can. They say we have no choice but to bow down to Brussels. We say they are woefully underestimating this country and what it can do. If we vote leave, we can take back control of our borders, of huge sums of money, £10 billion a year net, of our tax-raising powers, of our trade policy, and of our whole law-making system, the democracy that is the foundation of our prosperity. And if we stand up for democracy, we will be speaking up for hundreds of millions of people around Europe who agree with us, but who currently have no voice. And if we vote leave and take back control, I believe that this Thursday can be our country's Independence Day.
That's right. Is tomorrow going to be the Independence Day? Are they going to purge Britain of the parasites and the toxins? How's that for a transition to a deep cleanse special? Seriously, InfoWarsLife.com. We all know that a clean, toxin-free body is the foundation of true health. That's why we've developed Deep Cleanse. It's an all-in-one total body cleanser that doesn't cut any corners. This natural formula incorporates the chemical and toxic metal cleansing ability of organic zeolites in combination with powerful cleansing herbs. You can read over 100 five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. Find out what this product is about, how it can help you get rid of the parasites, the toxins in your body, just as they're trying to get rid of them in Britain, hopefully tomorrow. You can get it for 20% off right now, InfoWarsLife.com. New special, 20% off Deep Cleanse at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, as we're talking about the parasites, here's an article from InfoWars.com. Paul Joseph Watson, the EU even tries to control the volume at which we listen to music in Britain. He says the joyless Brussels bureaucracy regulates every aspect of our lives. EU regulations are becoming so invasive that the unelected bureaucracy even tries to control the volume at which European citizens can listen to music on their iPhone. Now, as we look at that, there was a story that was up on the Drudge Report yesterday from the Daily Mail. Don't call them robots. Europe's mechanical workers could become electronic persons. Who's going to do something that crazy? Why? Of course, it would be the European Union. And they're even proposing that there's going to have to be a social security pension plan for the robots who take their jobs. How's that? That's the next level after they bring in the migrants. They bring in the robots. Want to talk about a precariat? You want to talk about the precarious people with pitchforks and torches? Let's hope they turn out to vote tomorrow. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In our next segment, we're going to be joined by Lord Monckton from the EU, from the UK. Actually, he's in the EU right now. They want to get out of the EU, and they want to become their own sovereign nation again. He's going to talk about Brexit, which is the vote coming up tomorrow as to whether or not Britain will leave or whether they will remain in the European Union. This is an issue that is of global importance. What we are facing right now across the globe is a contest between global governance and individual liberty. As we remove government farther from us, we lose our freedoms more and more. As power is consolidated, that's what our founders were concerned about. That's why they created in the Constitution, they divided power between the states and between the central government. They were very concerned that the central government was going to become the overriding monster that we have today. They knew that was going to happen eventually. They tried to put some checks and balances in there, but unfortunately, the Constitution is not a self-enforcing document. And so they created a division of power between the states, between the people. The Senate was supposed to represent the states. The people were represented by the House of Representatives. And they were supposed to give some level of check to the central government. Then the central government, they tried to divide into three branches as well to keep power from being consolidated. And yet we've seen what has happened with that. Now we've moved beyond that. Now we have these central nation states. And these wars happened in the 1860s. It happened in America. We had a civil war. But also at the same time throughout Europe, there were wars of consolidation, wars that were being fought between industrial and agrarian interests. So you can look at the war that happened in Italy, for example. There was a civil war in Italy, same agrarian versus industrial interests. And it was a bloody civil war in Italy as well. Look up Garibaldi's army. So we had this consolidation that happened into the nation states. Now the nation states are consolidating into global governance, but there is a pushback. In America, we have the Donald Trump campaign. In Europe, there are political parties that are forming to fight this. And what we see happening is the potential that Europe and this concentration of power, as they're trying to consolidate to the next level with these global trade agreements, that it may begin to unravel at the bottom. So they're fighting this with everything that they have. Now, before we go to Lord Monckton, I want to play the beginning of this movie that you can watch online. It's called Brexit the Movie. And I want to play the trailer for their movie because it lays this down for you as to what's at stake. If you're not following this, if you're in Britain and you're not following it, shame on you. But if you're in America and you haven't really followed this, this will give you an idea for this. Let's go to the trailer for Brexit the Movie.
We, the people, are being cajoled, frightened, and bullied into surrendering our democracy and freedom. This film is a rallying cry. We must fight for our independence, for the right to determine ourselves, the laws under which we live, and for the freedom to shape our own future.
This is the most important voting decision that any of us is going to make in our lifetime. With general elections, it doesn't really matter who you vote for, Conservative or Labour, because you know that in 4 years' time, you can change your mind. This time, you can't change your mind. This time is for keeps.
In this film, we'll see how the EU works.
It's like heaven for the politician or bureaucrat, because it's power without accountability.
It was devised to make sure that the great mass of the people could not control government ever again.
The EU is turning into a dictatorship, and this is not overstating it.
We will see what the EU has done to Britain.
The EU has just obliterated the English fishing industry altogether.
The European policies that we face are really the single biggest threat to our competitiveness.
We'll see why Fortress Europe has been such a calamity for the European economy.
What we see is the EU bringing up the drawbridge.
The European Union has become an economic basket case.
Certainly, it is not in our economic interests to remain within the European Union. No way.
We will look at the risks of tying our fate to the failing EU.
Extremism at both ends is being fostered by the anti-democratic nature of the European Union.
Far from being it safer for us to be in the EU, there are dangers.
All right, so you can see the rest of that, and you can watch that movie online to define what that is. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining us now is Lord Christopher Monckton from the UK. We're going to talk about Brexit, which comes up for a vote tomorrow. You heard the clip in the last hour. We had Boris Johnson close the debates last night, made a rousing speech saying, all you hear from the other side is fear. We offer you the opportunity to take control of your lives. He said tomorrow can be our Independence Day. So we're going to talk to Lord Monckton about that. So we have introduction, of course. If you're a listener to Infowars.com, you've heard him on many times. We have Lord Monckton on to talk. He is an expert on global warming. He's been very effective at fighting the lies of Al Gore and others, the censorship that we see surrounding man-made global warming narratives. He's done that in the UK. Of course, he's also a businessman. He's a newspaper editor. He's an inventor, a classical architect, and, of course, the high priest of climate skepticism. But today we're going to talk to him about what's going on with globalism. Also, if you want to find Lord Monckton, you can find him at scienceandpublicpolicy.org, where you'll find many of his papers published. and whatsupwiththat.com, where you'll find information where he exposes the lies of climate alarmism. But today we're going to talk about Brexit. We're going to talk about the economic issues. We're going to talk about the sovereignty issues. We're going to talk about the political consequences, both in Britain and in the United States, because this is a worldwide issue that is happening right now. Joining us now is Lord Christopher Monckton. Thank you for joining us, Lord Monckton.
Well, David, it's a pleasure to be with you. And my goodness, it's exciting here because I can't tell you who is going to win this vote tomorrow. I hope it's going to be the Brexiteers. I've already cast my vote by post, but it's too close to call. It could go either way. But you're quite right. In your introduction and in that wonderful film, and all of the people that, who you showed clips of are friends of mine, this is an enormous blow. The fact that we've even got this referendum is an enormous blow against global government power. Yeah. They didn't ever want us to have this vote. And at least we've got the chance to have our say. And it's very evenly divided between, roughly speaking, the left and the centre-right, between the establishment and the ordinary folk, between the givers and the gobblers, to use the Ayn Rand's metric. And what is fascinating is that practically the entire global establishment, so terrified are they at the idea of Britain leaving the EU, that we've had Mr. Obama speaking out, we've had Angela Merkel, the president of Germany, speaking out, we've had the chancellor, as she's called, we've had François Hollande speaking out, we've had the head of the World Bank speaking out, we've had all manner, with the head of the Bank of England, who is not allowed to speak out of political matters, he has spoken out, and all of these are, of course, wanting us to stay in because they want to tie us in to this increasingly globalized government system.
And, yes, and further away, we have no control over what's going on in your lives. And I think that's the key phrase there, that rousing speech that was given by Boris Johnson, where he says, tomorrow can be our Independence Day. I mean, do Britons really want to govern themselves, or do they want to be governed by some European superstate that is dominated by the Germans? I really don't understand that. I mean, there was a back and forth talking about Neville Chamberlain, and they made a good point on that the other day when they questioned Cameron on that. I want to play that clip and get your reactions to it. But I see that as another issue of appeasement and surrender.
That is a very fair comparison. And of course, the entire establishment throughout Europe was for appeasement in the era immediately before the Second World War. And I'll bet you'll never guess which the first state to speak out against Hitler openly and publicly was.
What was that?
It was actually the Holy See. It was the Pope Pius XII, as he was to become. He was then secretary to Pope Pius XI, who issued in German an encyclical letter, the first time it hadn't been in Latin since the early Middle Ages. And it was called Mit brennender Sorge, with profound concern. The Holy See spoke out against the Hitler regime, while everybody else, the Times of London, was for appeasement. I mean, indeed, the Daily Express in 1933 had disgraced itself by running a front page story shortly after Hitler came to power saying Germany is Britain's friend. And the author of its lead story was not one of its journalists. It was Joseph Goebbels. That was how much the establishment wanted the German Reich to survive and prosper. And now they want the new bureaucratic, the tyranny by Clark, which again is anti, it's not just undemocratic, it's anti-democratic. And again, the establishment, which now hates democracy, viscerally hates democracy, wants to use the EU as a model for spreading effectively dictatorship worldwide. And you're quite right, David, when you say that democracy and independence are the issue. Are we going to be once again a sovereign nation? Are we going to get our independence back? And when you think that Britain was a great, proud, and independent nation, the last time anyone invaded us was in 1066 AD. And now here we have the European Union invading us by stealth. Yes. And of course, about half the population will tend to side with the establishment, the gobblers, the people who are on the take. They love the EU because it's a paradise of vested interests. There are 20,000 lobbyists who infest Brussels and Strasbourg, and their job is to argue for various vested interests to get free handouts from the European Union, of course, at British and other taxpayers' expense. And how much say do we get in any of this? It gets back to your point, David, about democracy and independence. At the moment, according to the House of Commons Library, which has just done a survey, 3 laws in 5 that are made for us by our Parliament in the United Kingdom are in fact only made because Brussels says we must make those laws. Wow. These laws are being enacted because the European Union's commissars, 28 unelected people who meet behind closed doors, have issued what is revealingly called a directive, which we are then obliged, under pain of unlimited and continuing fines, to enact into law in the United Kingdom. Now, the German government did a survey 5 years ago, and its conclusion, which was put in front of its constitutional court at the time, which had insisted that this sum be done, they said that, in fact, 5/6 of all laws, 5 laws in 6, not even 2 in 3, but 5 in 6, wow, were, in fact, enacted solely because directives by the unelected, unremovable, unaccountable, unquestionable commissars had ordered these laws to be made. That is how far from democracy we are. Now, you may say, oh, but I've heard of a thing called the European Parliament. Well, don't imagine that that is anything like a parliament. It is a fig leaf to cover the naked dictatorship behind. And this parliament cannot even bring forward a bill. Can you imagine if the United States had set up a constitution whereby the Congress was not allowed in either house ever to bring forward any new legislation?
We're getting close to that.
Isn't allowed. Yes, the European Parliament, of course, you are under Obama getting used to that, but that's not how it was supposed to work.
That's right, that's right.
And yet the Constitution of Europe is that the supreme law of Europe is proposed behind closed doors by the 28 commissars, is drafted behind closed doors by a committee called the Council of Ministers, which doesn't actually have any ministers on it. It's entirely bureaucrats. There's also a rather shadowy group called the Council of Permanent Representatives, another lot of bureaucrats that have their say. Then and only then it goes to the European Parliament. And of course, if right at the outset the commissars have decided to veto whatever law it was, then the European Parliament doesn't get its say at all. So this shows how undemocratic it is. And if the European Parliament should agree to the law proposed by the commissars, well, then it gets inflicted on us. But if they disagree, it gets inflicted on us anyway, because the commissars have and frequently exercise the right under the Treaty of Maastricht, in 5 different places it says this, to override, the unelected commissars can override the decisions of the elected Parliament of Europe. So this is an entirely anti-democratic constitution. In fact, it's very like the Soviet constitution on which it was modeled. And all that's happened is the Soviet constitution has moved westward. And we are now effectively the European Supreme Soviet.
And I would add, Lord Monckton, that what we are now looking at with the Trans-Pacific and the Transatlantic Partnership, Senator Sessions, who's one of the only senator that I know that actually looked at the agreement, has essentially said, we're going to have the same thing with these trade agreements, where we're going to have an unelected, unaccountable bureaucracy that is going to be able to alter these things at will. There will be a living document, and we will have absolutely no control over them. So what you just described there in the European Union, where they can override all these deals, and of course, it's always about the money. They sell this as an economic opportunity, as an economic union, but then they use it to take our sovereignty. As Boris Johnson has said, and he's been one of the key voices on this, he says, we remain prisoners of a trade regime that will not allow this country, the 5th biggest economy on earth, to negotiate with America, China, India, or any other nation. He says that privilege is reserved exclusively for the hierarchies of the European Commission, of whose vast staff only 3.6% are British. Now, if they get this Trans-Pacific, Transatlantic Partnership, that will go from 3.6% to 0% for you. It'll go to 0% for America. We will have no say over the trade issues for our countries.
That's right. Now, we now have to do something about this. Of course, in Britain, if anybody is listening to this from Britain, for heaven's sake, if you still believe in democracy, and a surprising number don't, but if you do, then for heaven's sake, you have to vote Leave. It is as simple as that. Don't be fooled by all the economic arguments that The Treasury has simply made up numbers to try and say we would go bankrupt if we were out of the EU. We'll go bankrupt for sure if we're in it. Let me give you one figure that tells you just how badly Britain has done in the EU.
Hang on with that figure, Lord Monckton. We've got to go to a commercial break, and we'll be right back. And we also have a clip. We'll talk about the other issue that came up in this, and of course, that is immigration. That has economic consequences, but it has vast consequences for the entire society. We'll talk about that when we come back with Lord Monckton. Brexit is tomorrow. Will it be Britain's Independence Day or the day they quietly cease to exist? We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to go back to Lord Monckton. He had, we had to go to a commercial break. He had one key factor that he wanted to tell us about with the Brexit. Of course, that's coming up tomorrow. The vote is whether or not Britain will leave the European Union. Before we get back to Lord Monckton, I just want to let you know we do have a special, a new special at InfoWars.com. Deep Cleanse, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. This is a way to give yourself a foundation of true health by getting rid of the toxins in your body to clean your body. You can look at the reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. We have over 100 five-star reviews. Find out what this product is about. People love this, and you can get it right now, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, our Hillary for Prison t-shirt, such a great design that even our enemies at Slate did a massive article on the effect that it had at a Donald Trump rally. And again, you can get these at 50% off. This is a one-week special, 50% off the first shirt and 75% off your second shirt. That's Hillary for Prison t-shirt. Let's go back to Lord Monckton. Lord Monckton, as we're going to the break, you were about to make a point. Go ahead.
Yes, it's a very simple figure about the economics of all this, which needs to be looked at very briefly, and that is that in the last two decades, the stock market in London has had its worst two decades in 650 years of operation.
Wow.
That's how well the EU has done for us. The EU has generally underperformed in the last 20 or 30 years just about all the other developed economies. And it is dragging all of us down with exactly this kind of bureaucratic mishmash of controls and regulations run by people we can't elect and can't remove that you talk of in the transatlantic trade partnership system. And what is happening here is that people like Mr. Obama, who have realized that communism is no longer popular, but who want to build in perma-communism into whatever they do, have discovered that if they make international treaties, either bilateral or multilateral, it doesn't very much matter. Under your constitution, those treaties have the force of supreme law in the United States. And they can't be repealed unilaterally as your own laws can. That's the difference. And what is more, all the powers that are transferred, whether it be to the Transatlantic Trade Partnership, whether it be to the European Stability Pact, the European Union, the World Bank, the World Law of the Sea Conference, it doesn't matter which of these entities it is, the UN is another one, there are a growing number of them, all of them very expensive. Not one of these supranational or global bodies has its governing council elected by us, the people of the states parties, to the treaties that set those bodies up. So every time you transfer power from elected hands in the democracies to a global or supranational organization, you're transferring it from elected to unelected hands every time. So every time somebody says, oh, we've got a new wonderful treaty, you will know with a terrible certainty that another large piece of your democracy has been sliced away like a piece of salami. And this is the intention of the left now, is to govern entirely by dictatorship. And so far has it gone that, to give you an example, which is being mirrored in the Transatlantic Trade Partnership, which is why I mention it to you in America too, is that the European Stability Pact, to which Britain doesn't belong because we're not part of the failing euro currency zone. But the regulations, that the treaty that sets up that pact creates a governing council which can, at will, whenever it likes, call upon any of the member states of that group, the European Stability Pact, for unlimited amounts of money. And what is more, the people who are on this governing council, who are of course elected by nobody, they're so unaccountable that even if they decided to take the money and run off with it and put it into their bank accounts in the Cayman Islands or Switzerland or Belgium, which is now becoming one of the biggest money laundering centres in the world, then the Stability Pact terms say that those people cannot be prosecuted and they cannot be sued in any civil court either. They are completely immune. They have absolute financial power over all the countries that belong to that treaty, absolute power. And even if they choose to exercise that power criminally, nobody can do anything to stop them.
Wow.
That is how, that, and that, of course, is
That's
dictatorship.
Amazing.
In the formal sense.
Well, now, of course, even though you're not in the, not a part of the euro, the mismanagement of the euro is driving immigration from the European Union into Britain. As the questions were being presented to David Cameron the other night, people were saying, why is it that unskilled workers that are being put out of work by mismanagement in these other states are given preference over skilled immigrants coming into our country? When we come back, we're going to take a look at what happened in that question and answer period with David Cameron. And we have Lord Monckton talking about the Brexit vote coming up tomorrow. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lord Monckton. Of course, the vote as to whether or not Britain is going to remain or leave the European Union is tomorrow. Will it be Britain's Independence Day, as Boris Johnson said in his closing remarks, or will they lose the opportunity? We'll see what happens. It is neck and neck. And, of course, they were up by 19 points before the member of parliament was killed last week, 1 week before the election. And now we've seen a 26-point swing in some of the polls. Right now, they have recovered, and it looks like it is neck and neck. Nobody is predicting that. I see that as a very bad sign, because we always know that the vested interests are going to be able to swing the votes. I know that's the case in America. We'll ask Lord Monckton what he thinks about that in the UK as well. But before we get back to Lord Monckton, I want to point out we've extended the Tim Kennedy special for one more day. That's our 15% off of Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. These are the products that Tim Kennedy, as you've seen him talk to Alex Jones, and of course, he is not only a special forces, but he also is a UFC fighter, and he trains intensively for both of those things. And he says what helps him the most, that he has felt the biggest improvement in, are these three products: Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12. And so we put those together, call it the Tim Kennedy special, 15% off. It's been such a big seller. Alex has extended that one more day at InfoWarsLife.com. 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12. That's the Tim Kennedy special. Lord Monckton, I want to play this clip from the question and answer period a couple of days ago with David Cameron. And it touches on a huge part of this issue, and of course, that's immigration. That is an economic issue, as well as a cultural issue, as well as a crime issue. We see what's happening throughout Europe. This is what the people said. Of course, this is a television program. They had an audience. They said it was evenly divided between people who were for and against remaining in the European Union and some people who were undecided, they said. And they let the audience ask questions to David Cameron, the prime minister. And here's a couple of those questions real quickly. I want to get your response after we play this.
Mr. Cameron, you keep saying that you propose to stop immigrants allowing to claim benefits. Is this just a proposal, or can you enforce it, or have you got to go back to the EU to get it
Very
enforced?
It's agreed. Yes, sir. It's agreed by the 27 other prime ministers and presidents. It's part of what will become a legally binding document. And these changes are coming in. The head of the European Parliament has said that too. Right. So these are things. They come in. If we vote yes to remain in the reformed European Union on Thursday, those proposals get put in front of the European Parliament and start to be passed straight away.
What happens if somebody vetoes you?
Well, they've all agreed they won't. This is, they've all agreed.
You say that your policy that you've negotiated with Europe cannot be overruled. Yep. It can. So are you really the 21st century Neville Chamberlain waving a piece of paper in the air, saying to the public, this is what I have. I have this promise where a dictatorship in Europe can overrule it. That simple question.
question. Yes or no, please. What I can say to you is the other 27 prime ministers and presidents have agreed it. And they know if Britain votes to remain, they will implement it. And I think, you know, look, this is not some empire and dictatorship. We're proving.
There you go. Prove it. He says you're just a Neville Chamberlain waving a piece of paper that has absolutely no effect. You've got some promises from these people. They can renege on these promises. He says, they told me if we stay in, they're going to do something to improve this immigration thing. They're not buying it. Lord Monckton, your comments.
Imagine if you in the United States were told that you had to depend on the will of 27 other nations, any one of whom could say no to you.
Yeah.
Now, the history of Britain's appeals, for instance, to the so-called European so-called Court of so-called Justice, which is the European Union's rubber stamp court, is that in 80% of all cases brought by Britain to try to get its way in the European Union, under David Cameron, it has lost those cases. The average has been 75%, and it's now gone up to 80% that we lose. We have absolutely no influence whatsoever. And in all 72 instances of where the British Parliament has tried to say no under David Cameron to European laws, in every single one of those cases, the European law has been enacted anyway. We have absolutely no say in Europe. And David Cameron is pretending that somehow we are all in the club together and we can do what we want. The fact is, the only way we can control immigration, and you're quite right that after democracy, immigration is the next biggest issue. The only way we can control immigration is to come out of the EU. And I'll give you the figures to show you why it is. We are getting something like a million people a year in net terms coming into the UK and staying there. How do we know? Because although the official immigration figures say it's about 300,000 or 400,000, the true figures are given by what are called the national insurance numbers issued. And something like 600,000 of those every year are being issued to EU nationals coming to Britain, and another 400,000 being issued to foreigners, so who are beyond the EU. So we know that immigration is at two or three times the rate the official figures show, because national insurance numbers, you can't work without one, you can't claim benefit without one. The two things that people want to do when they come to Britain is either to work or to claim benefit. So we know from that immigration is on a far larger scale than this government wants to admit. We know it. We know that the vast majority of that immigration is coming just from the 27 other nations of the EU rather than from the 200 other nations worldwide. And so we know that if we want to control immigration, staying in the EU is simply not an option. Those are the hard figures, the figures that don't really get into the papers much. The Daily Telegraph revealed this morning or yesterday morning this scam by which the government is undercounting immigration by a very, very large scale. And the national insurance numbers which allow you to work or to claim benefit are the much more revealing figure. And the revenue people, the IRS in the UK, actually keep statistics on who these numbers are being allocated to every year. So we know that immigration is happening at a far larger scale than it should. And we know that the only way to control that is to come out. Now, let's look at Cameron's saying that he's got the agreement of the other 27 member states. Fact is that all that has to happen now is a coalition against us in the European Parliament, because everybody except Britain wants immigration to continue to be free and easy, because they can just export the immigrants straight to Britain, where they all seem to end up, because we have a more generous benefit system, one with far fewer checks on it, and also everybody speaks English, which they don't in most other European countries. So everybody who is an immigrant wants to come to Britain because it's a civilized and friendly place as well. So they may well, in the European Parliament, say, well, we're going to vote this down. Now, of course, the commissars could simply say they were going to push it through anyway, but they don't like Britain, so they probably wouldn't. And what David Cameron is admitting to here is, in effect, is that he has lost control of immigration completely, and he has no control whatsoever about what the European Union will do to us if we remain. The only way we will get control over our immigration is if we come out of the European Union, and then we can tell people from the European Union. How many of them can come in? We'll obviously want skilled workers to come in. We'll want people who are being treated badly by the EU or by any member state to come in via the asylum rules, just as we always have done internationally. If you're in hardship and you have nowhere else to turn, Britain will always welcome you. What we're not going to have is this tide of economic migrants. I mean, there'll be another 72 million of them if Turkey joins the EU.
Yes.
And although Mr. Cameron pretends he doesn't want Turkey to join the EU privately, behind the scenes, he's been working overtime to try and get Turkey in. He is trying quite deliberately to destroy Britain as an independent country so as to establish this world elite dictatorship. If anybody is listening thinks this sounds extreme, that is because his ambition is extreme. The ambition of these people is to do away with democracy altogether. And the single biggest threat to their plan is this vote tomorrow. So if you are listening in the United Kingdom, or you have friends in the United Kingdom who are dithering about how to vote, tell them that this is their one chance to do not only Britain, but also Europe and the world a favour by striking a blow, and a very strong blow, for democracy. And I suppose we might use the words of a well-known film, and we might say, we will not go quietly into the night. We will not go without a fight. And
good,
this will be our Independence Day.
Yes, yes. I hope that will be the case. And of course, as you're talking about immigration, it is not simply the quantity of immigration that is causing economic difficulty, but it's also the quality of immigration. We have an article on Infowars.com. Calais migrants are rioting and they're chanting F the UK. They demand access to Britain. It's bone-chilling footage that shows their car. Some British holidaymakers driving through thick clouds of tear gas as French riot police battle in vain to restore control on the road leading to the town's port. And of course, this is something that has been going on for quite some time in Calais. They cannot control the situation that's going there. As you mentioned, David Cameron wants to have Turkey in. This is something else that came up in this question and answer period, as they pointed out, and he didn't deny it. He said, yes, I have said that I would very much like for Turkey to be a member of the European Union. They are already a member of NATO. But he goes, that's not going to happen in my lifetime. I can't really see that happening for another 30 years. And you know, Lord Monckton, it reminded me of the Old Testament story about Hezekiah, where he has the Babylonians come to visit him in Jerusalem, and he shows them all the treasures of Jerusalem. And after they leave, Isaiah comes into him and goes, what have you done? And he goes, here's the message from God. He says, these people will take your sons, and they will turn them into slaves and eunuchs. And his response is, good, it won't happen in my lifetime. I mean, that's what we're seeing from David Cameron. Great, that's not going to happen in my lifetime. It'll happen 30 years from now. But it may not happen 30 years from now. It may be sooner. But what a despicable attitude that he would say, fine, we'll let them loot Britain and destroy this country because it won't happen in my lifetime. I'll be able to enjoy this in my lifetime.
Well, that is a very nice parallel. The other favorite one I have from biblical times is that curious story of the Lord of Life when he went into the desert. And the devil visited him there and said, oh, look at this splendid world. I will give all of this to you if only you follow me. Now, that was a very curious and rather dumb thing for the devil to say, because, of course, the Lord of Life already owned the world and indeed the whole universe. Didn't need to be given it by anybody. And so often we are given these exaggerated promises by the forces of evil that either that something good will happen when they know perfectly well it won't, or that something bad, if it ever were to happen, wouldn't happen in their lifetime. This is the line that the devil always uses to try to buy people's support.
Yes.
And talking of buying people's support, that's really what the entire Remain campaign, the people who want to stay in the EU, that's what they've been doing. They've been using two things. One is fear, saying we can't survive on our own in the tough old world if we come out of the EU. Well, it wasn't that long ago that we had an empire that covered a quarter of the globe and the sun never set on it. It's not as though we haven't had practice in making our own way in the world. We still have our special relationship with the United States, despite Mr. Obama having removed the bust of Churchill from the White House. We still have our special relationship with the Commonwealth of Nations, including one nation, Mozambique, that never was part of the British Empire, that applied to join because it liked the friendliness and common sense of purpose that the Commonwealth has. And so all of these links that we already have, and of course we also have many friendly links with Europe. One thing you should not ever think, David, is that those of us who are tired of the European Union are anti-European. We are pro-European. I studied the ancient civilizations of Greece and Rome, and I'm a huge admirer of the contribution that Europe has made to our civilization in music, in art, in architecture, in literature, in science, in so many different fields. Europe has been the cradle of today's civilization.
Yes.
So why then would I wish to sever myself from it? The answer is I don't. But the European Union is not only anti-democratic, it is anti-European. It stands against the continent that gave the world not only the concept, but also the name of democracy. It stands against the civilization, the Christian civilization, that has been such a gentle force throughout the world, such a force for good on balance. Not that us Christians are perfect by any means, but at least we're trying to be. And this is all rejected by the European Union. So your raising of the biblical quotation there is a very important one. Because although most of our church leaders who are left-wing are therefore in favor of the European Union, some of them are beginning to wake up to the fact that the biggest threat to religion here in Britain is the European Union itself. This is a growing problem now. For instance, no Catholic ends up as a commissar, or very few of them do, because they're subjected to a grilling, a public grilling by the other commissars. And one of the questions they tend to get asked is, what is your view about homosexuality? And of course, if you're Catholic, you say, well, I'm terribly sorry, but the church is against it. I'm not against any individual homosexual, but what they do is something that we think is wrong. And it's wrong because it's medically dangerous. And if you say that, you can't become a commissar. So they're already getting into the moral sphere as well as the economic sphere and the political sphere and the democratic sphere and taking over and allowing only one point of view, which is generally a very left-wing and very anti-religious point of view, to prevail.
And it's not just in appointing people into office, as Boris Johnson pointed out. He went through, it was about a month ago, and I covered it and talked about the parallels between the reasons that he said would be good for Britain to get out of the European Union. And I said, hey, these are all great reasons for Texas to get out of the United States, to secede from the United States. We ought to have a Texit. And actually, there was an article that came out a couple of days ago from The Guardian. I guess they saw that, or they were talking to some Texas independence people and called it Texit. But one of the things that he said was, would be able to get out from under the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice, which is increasingly arbitrating in questions over which we never thought it would have any power, like the rights of a child, getting into the family. And so they've got a court that is intruding itself into the details of individual life. It's not just excluding people because of their religious beliefs, but it's that kind of intolerance. And, you know, you mentioned Winston Churchill a couple of times as bust. We talked about the issue of whether or not David Cameron is acting like Neville Chamberlain. When Winston Churchill talked in the history of the English-speaking people about the American Brexit, our revolution, what he said was it was a liberating force for Britain. He said what it did was it enabled them to strengthen parliamentary democracy. And I think the people you're talking about, there's no animosity, there's no xenophobia about the people of Europe. You don't want to isolate yourself from them. But it is something that the European groups themselves want, self-government, just like you want it in Britain. And so it would be a liberating thing for all of the people of Europe. That is why the powers that be, the political globalist powers, why all of the industrialists and people like George Soros, all the central bankers are working so hard to defeat this referendum tomorrow. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Lord Monckton, and we're going to have more Trump coverage coming up in the... Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lord Monckton. We're talking about the upcoming election tomorrow, Brexit. Will Britain leave the European Union? Will they vote for freedom, for self-government? Or will they be subsumed into this expanding Borg? Now, just before we went to break, we mentioned Texit. And Lord Monckton, about a month ago, Boris Johnson, former mayor of London, came out and gave 8 reasons why Britain would be better off outside of the European Union. And when he did that, I played each one of the points and I said, you know, what would happen if Texas left the United States if we seceded successfully. And like the first point, he says, well, there's £350 million per week that are going to the European Union net that we're losing. And I looked at our numbers and I came up with $1.5 billion per week going to the federal government net from Texans. And so we would have that money to spend. So there are all these different parallels. We go step by step and say, hey, why can't we govern ourselves? Texas is 10 times larger than all 13 colonies were combined at the time they did their Brexit. So clearly we have a much more diversified economy. We have our own energy sources, just as Britain does. We could go it alone as well. But we don't have...
In the Daily Caller a month ago. And I was recommending that Texas should indeed secede. I believe it has a right under its own constitution when it joined the Union to reserve the chance to secede if it ever wished to do so. And I believe it's the only state that has this special privilege. However, under the post-colonial disposition in international law, where the right of self-determination of peoples is paramount, if the people of Texas, which is quite large enough and economically prosperous enough to be viable as an independent state, chose to become independent, whether or not the United States Constitution or the Texas Constitution allows it, if the people of Texas want it, then they should have it. And I know the Republican leadership in Texas rather shabbily managed to divert.
We're getting a little bit of problem there with the reception on our Skype. It's starting to drop out. Are we back now?
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
Yes, we lost you there for a moment on Skype. Go ahead. We're back.
Okay, I'll just carry on. I was saying that Texas makes a lot of sense. You have the right to secede, even if the United States says you haven't, and even if the Texas Constitution says you haven't.
That's
if
right.
The people wish it, under the post-colonial disposition in international law, you are entitled to become independent whenever you wish to do so.
Well, Boris Johnson is talking about Independence Day. That's what our Declaration of Independence says. I mean, there certainly wasn't any legal authority for them to do it from the British Crown. There wasn't any opportunity from the king to say, well, you can just leave whenever you want to. They took that right. They declared that right because they said as human beings, we have these natural rights that we possess to secure our liberties. That's the reason that we create governments. That's the fundamental basis for our government. So I'm in favor of anybody having self-government at any level.
And that is how international law now works, particularly in the post-colonial era. And I'm going to make you an offer here, David. I'm going to say this. On behalf of Her Majesty and the British government, if Texas would like to leave the United States and rejoin the crown, then the only tax you will pay is half a crown a pound on tea, and the rest you won't have to pay. Now, you compare that with what your federal government charges, and you see that you'll be better off under the crown than you would under the United States.
Well, we would have that taxation with some representation. See, the problem we have now, Lord Monckton, is we have regulation without representation, just as you do in the EU, except ours is coming from the federal bureaucracy. They enact an even larger bureaucratic burden on us than the European Union does on Britain. Stay with us right after the top of the hour. We're going to be back with Lord Monckton for another 5 minutes. Thank you for sticking around for another 5 minutes. Then after that, Alex Jones is going to be joining us with more comments about Donald Trump's speech today. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lord Monckton. We've been talking about the vote coming up tomorrow as to whether or not Britain will leave the European Union. But now I want to switch gears. I want to talk to Lord Monckton about another vote that's coming up tomorrow, one that's in California. This is a vote as to whether or not California will leave its senses. Well, I should say leave their senses, because they've done it in so many different ways. This is something, of course, we've talked about many times. And Lord Monckton, usually when he comes on, he's talking about climate change. Again, you can find him at scienceandpublicpolicy.org, scienceandpublicpolicy.org, and What's Up With That. That's WATTS, whatsupwiththat.com. You can find Lord Monckton's writings there. Now, we've seen Bill Nye come out and say that there needs to be RICO prosecution against people who deny man-made global warming. Tomorrow, we have a vote scheduled in California. The Senate is going to vote on a first-of-its-kind legislation scheduled for floor action tomorrow. The measure would allow state and local prosecutors to pursue claims against climate change skepticism as a violation of the state's unfair competition law, as well as extend the four-year statute of limitations for such claims retroactively to 2021. January the 1st, 2021. The bill, according to the Senate Rules Committee analysis, it says this bill explicitly authorizes district attorneys and the California Attorney General to pursue these claims, alleging that a business or organization has directly or indirectly engaged in unfair competition just because you are engaging in scientific discussion. That is absolutely amazing, Lord Monckton. Your comments.
Well, that is communism. Yes. And I'm not surprised that California, of all places, should be the first state to try this on. It's also directly contrary, as I understand it, to the First Amendment to your Constitution, which guarantees the right of free speech.
Yes.
So I don't think this bill, even if it were passed as a sort of gesture to please the communist left, which now infests most of California, I don't think even the Obama-tainted Supreme Court could possibly allow such a bill to stand. It would be struck down the first time a case was brought under it. So I don't think that's a realistic problem, really. The other thing is, of course, that the one thing that the communist left will not do is take any climate skeptic to court. Because, of course, in a court, whether they like it or not, both sides have to be fairly heard in the way that they're not fairly heard in the mainstream or Marxstream media. The fact is that in a court, both sides are fairly heard. And when we took Al Gore's movie to court in the High Court in London, the first firm of solicitors we tried to engage to do this refused to take the case on the grounds that we had absolutely no chance of winning. And so I was consulted by the people who wanted to bring the case, and I said, well, just find another firm of solicitors, and I will give them scientific testimony, which will demonstrate that the film is not scientific, it's anti-scientific, it's political, it's left-wing political at that. And under an Act of Parliament, the Education Act 1988, which I helped to draft when I worked at 10 Downing Street with Margaret Thatcher, it's illegal to take sides in politics in schools. You can by all means have political discussions, but you mustn't take sides. And I said that because all these errors in Al Gore's movie pointed in one direction, towards undue and anti-scientific alarm, the film shouldn't be shown unless corrective guidance were circulated. We won that case. And exactly the same would happen in court case against it. And they took that case in California. I'm sorry, it's breaking up again.
Yes, we broke
then
up a little
bit.
If
they tried to take that case, even to the left-wing judges in California, once they hear the arguments on both sides, they will realize that it is, in fact, the communist left and the climate change extremists who are wrong and the skeptics who are correct.
The truth will out. Thank you so much, Lord Monckton, and I hope that you vote for your Independence Day tomorrow. We'll all be watching. All the eyes of the world will be on Britain tomorrow. We'll be right back with Alex Jones's analysis of Donald Trump's speech today. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We were just talking to Lord Monckton about this law that is going to be voted on tomorrow in California. It's coming to the Senate floor, as to whether or not they will use criminal prosecution to gag anyone who denies their man-made global warming. And of course, there's an article that came out last week from the Washington Times. GOP Attorney General has warned the Democrats that if climate skeptics can be prosecuted for fraud, so can alarmists. And that's exactly what Lord Monckton was talking about. They had their day in court, and he won. He proved that Al Gore's documentary, An Inconvenient Truth, was simply a convenient lie, and they banned it from being shown in the schools without accompanying rebuttal from the documents there. And of course, if they're going to do that in California, if they're going to try to censor anybody that disagrees with them, let's say, go ahead, throw me in that briar patch. We'll have that discussion. We'll have it in court, and we'll adjudicate the science in court, because that's really what we need to have, is we need to have a open discussion of this that we're not going to get in the media. Now, we're going to have Alex Jones has given us an analysis of Donald Trump's speech today. That was a speech that we've been waiting for quite some time. He said it was going to happen a week ago last Monday. But because of the shooting in Orlando that was delayed today, he unloaded on Hillary Clinton, a massive expose of Hillary Clinton. And Alex Jones is going to be joining us in just a moment with that analysis. Before we go to Alex, I just want to remind you that he's extended for one more day the Tim Kennedy special. This is 15% off Supermail Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. And, of course, we picked these products because these are the ones that Tim Kennedy, who trains as a professional athlete for the UFC fighters, as well as special forces. He trains 3 hours a day minimum. He said, these are the products that I can immediately feel. I gave these to the UFC, and they looked at them. They said, there's absolutely nothing that would disqualify you from being a competitor. These are safe. And he says, they're very effective. So we put these together in a special. It's been a very popular special. So Alex has extended this for one day. 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12, the products that Tim Kennedy says he felt helped him the most. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, you can read the reviews. Go to InfoWarsLife.com, see what other people say. We have hundreds of five-star reviews on those products. Find out about them. Get them now. Last day, 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, here's Alex's analysis of what Donald Trump said earlier today as he defined Hillary Clinton for us. World-class liar, he said.
Donald Trump did it. He delivered on his promise in a lengthy speech detailing the criminal activities and the corrupt activities of Hillary Clinton, from her corrupt foundation to giving secrets to the communist Chinese, to the mysterious death of Vince Foster, to all of her corrupt trade deals with foreign nations selling us out. He covered the waterfront. And today, throughout the 4 hours, we're going to be airing excerpts of this important speech. The full speech, unredacted, is posted as we speak to InfoWars.com. Now, earlier, I engaged in a little bit of a rant dealing with the fact that Slate Magazine and others are acting like I'm crazy for calling for a criminal investigation of Hillary and saying that she should be sent to prison, not the White House, in 2016. They're claiming that's conspiratorial. They're claiming it's mentally ill. They actually say it's part of a Republican psychosis, saying there's corruption in the Democratic Party. Well, let me tell you something. There's corruption in both parties. But the Democrats have been getting away with anything and everything forever, and it's getting worse, okay? And the Rhino Republicans have been up there protecting them. And so whether it's our movement for Hillary for prison or Donald Trump getting up there and exposing her crimes and corruption, this is all part of bringing reality back and saying, look, you don't control reality. And yes, folks, this is a theme I'm pushing. These people do not control reality. They think they do. They think they dictate to us like gods from Mount Olympus. And they don't. Hillary Clinton is one of the singularly most corrupt people in modern history that I could think of. She makes third world dictators in Latin America, Africa, Asia, and Eastern Europe look like choir boys. And all they've got is this gimmick that she's a woman. And they may double down and have Elizabeth Warren, the senator, as her running mate, Pocahontas, because she claims she's Native American and isn't. The media claims they don't get that joke from Trump. And look, I love the fact that Trump's not just exposing corruption. He's exposing political correctness and being politically incorrect to show people it's okay to say what you really think. It's okay to ridicule these people because they want to sit up there with these airs of invincibility like gods, as I said earlier, dictating to us from on high, from up on the mountain. And they're crooks. They have criminal histories. They're liars. They're known scammers. And it's time to start disrespecting them. It's time to start making fun of them. It's time to start, you know, doing what I did years ago when I said, hey, I got to go take a Queen Elizabeth II. People said, why would you make such a crude, gross joke? I'm not a crude, gross person. Because this woman takes herself so seriously. Her propaganda to worship her and her globalist organization is all over the media. And I, for one, am sick of it. So whether it's Queen Elizabeth II or whether it's Hillary Clinton, who's in the same guild, you know, in the same outhouse, these people are jokes and are frauds. And it's time that we pull these idols down. It's time we stop worshiping them. And that goes for Hollywood. That goes for hypocrites and people like Michael Moore, who have all these bodyguards who don't want you to be able to protect yourself. That goes for people like George Clooney, who has bodyguards, doesn't take in one refugee, but sits there and says Donald Trump's a racist. These people are pig-like frauds. And in closing, before we start playing some of these clips, I'm going to make this point. I'm coming after George Clooney, and I'm coming after Michael Moore, and I'm coming after, politically, and in the information war, I'm coming after all these hypocrites. We've already exposed them before, but take YouTube. In the last 6 months, whenever I load Spotify on my phone or my car, it launches the latest YouTube album from YouTube, and then tries to charge me.
And so I went ahead and Googled it last week, knowing it. And lo and behold, it's a two-year-old scam where they force load it, a hack, onto your Spotify and charge you. It's two guys on the cover hugging each other. Well, naked. I mean, that's what's getting so sick about this is I'm sitting there with my kids in the car. I plug in Spotify to play stories for them or music or whatever. And it just goes on and on and on. It's not just Spotify. It's iTunes as well and entire platforms across the system. So, again, this has been going on for 2 years on iTunes and Spotify and Lord knows what other platforms. Okay. That's just what comes up on Google. And they're still doing it. They don't care. And it gets 10 times worse. Remember you too. They give money, you know, to supposed charities, and then it was less than 1% they were actually giving to starving Africans and stuff like that. They would raise billions in some cases a year, have TV coverage everywhere, have people pay them, have all these sponsors, and then Bono keeps 99%. When he got criticized, he started giving 1.1% or 1.2%. But it's okay because he's liberal and wears red-lensed glasses. Why, if he wore purple lens, he might be somebody like John Lennon. The difference is John Lennon turned against the New World Order, started speaking out against it, and was murdered. And by the way, I don't just have that from pop culture. I know that directly from people very close. I'll just stop right there. These people are jokes, and they think you're stupid, and you're conning yourselves when you think they're not sitting there preying on you, laughing at you and your family, whether it's Bono and U2 and all of their scams. It doesn't matter. It's the same guild of predators. And look, I know our audience says, Alex, tell us something we don't know. We already know this. Stop lecturing us. Hey, I apologize if that's how this was taken. This is to the mainline trendies who don't know what's going on, who don't know what's happening, that don't know the whole world's being established and set up to run scams on them. That's who I'm reaching out to. Because this isn't my opinion. You have become chumps, super marks, super schmucks, super idiots, super targets, super prey to be fed on. And for heaven's sakes, break out of your trance and your conditioning. They think you're so passive and so stupid that they literally keep all the money from charity and run untold scams on everybody. And George Clooney sits up there and lectures us. I mean, this is just insane. But Bono's allowed to do it because he rubs elbows with the UN and he hangs out with the politicians and makes them feel important. It's just a bunch of sick filth that's taught us to worship them while they live and while we sleep. And I am done. This is a revolution against all these frauds. It's a revolution against celebrity. It's a revolution against false garbage. And it's a revolution of the true rise of humanity against this trash. It's time to hate them. It's time to absolutely disdain them. It's time to criticize them. It's time to spit on them. It's time to realize how filthy they are. It's time to replace foul words with their names. It's time to pull down their idols everywhere and absolutely know this filth hates you and your family and is preying on you and sucking your literal life force out of you. Now back to the global transmission.
Absolutely right. That's Alex Jones phoning in that report from the Road and analyzing what Donald Trump said today. And of course, we talked at the beginning of the program about this Slate article talking about Hillary for prison and saying, yeah, this is a psychosis of the GOP base. This is a longtime psychosis. And yet the lady that they talked to who has that Hillary for prison t-shirt that they talk about, she got it at Infowars.com. They say, well, she grew up liberal. She voted for Obama in 2008, but now she agrees when she hears Trump say that Obama might have something else in mind. Why does she agree that? She's not part of that long-term GOP psychosis. Their very article cannot escape the fact they have to admit. They say, well, in fact, yes, as she noted, Bill and Hillary's Clinton Foundation did take between $10 and $25 million from Saudi Arabia, millions more from other regimes and political actors that oppress the rights of women, gays, and religious minorities. The very people that Hillary Clinton says her whole campaign is to represent them. It's an identity campaign that she wants to run, and yet, she's taking money from the people that oppress these very people. She says she's going to help. And it truly is a criminal operation. We've seen this for a very long time. Some people are just now starting to wake up to it. Today, Donald Trump laid out the details, and we're going to play some more clips from what he said earlier today. We're also going to take your calls if you want to call in and give us your take on what Donald Trump said today. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. We'll take your calls on what Donald Trump said about Hillary Clinton. He defined her today broadly. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and of course, the big events today are the Brexit vote coming up tomorrow. We just talked to Lord Monckton about that. As the New American says, it's the billionaires and the globalists versus the people. Brexit D-Day vote is tomorrow. Here in the United States, we have a similar issue, and that is whether or not we're going to control our country or whether we're going to lose it to the globalists. And of course, our vote is not about leaving a union, but it's whether or not we're going to leave the establishment that has controlled our political process from both parties for a very long time. Donald Trump is the face of that vote. It's really about globalism versus nationalism when we look at the election that is coming up. Today, Donald Trump gave an extensive speech, and of course, he had promised to do this a week ago last Monday with the shooting in Orlando. It was postponed today. He covered broadly all the issues about Hillary Clinton's corruption, her character issues, and others. We're going to take your calls here in just a moment. Before we do, I want to play this one clip where he takes on her slogan, where she says, "I'm with her." That's her slogan. Here's what he has to say.
She believes she's entitled to the office. Her campaign slogan is, "I'm with her." You know what my response is to that? I'm with you, the American people.
Great. It's not about this individual. That's what we keep seeing. It's her sense of entitlement. He got that exactly right. He goes on.
I know it's all about you. I know it's all about making America great again for all Americans. All Americans. Our country lost its way when it stopped putting the American people really first. We have to go back to putting our American people first. We got here because we switched from a policy of Americanism, focusing on what's good for America's middle class, to a policy of globalism, focusing on how to make money for large corporations who can move their wealth and workers to foreign countries, all to the detriment of the American worker and the American economy itself.
Exactly. Now, what he did was it's brilliant. He took her slogan. She says, her slogan is, "I'm with her." He says, "No, I'm with you. I'm with the American people." What he could also do is he could take his slogan, "Make America Great," and say her campaign is really "Make Hillary Great." That's what she's saying. Get behind me, make me great. What he's saying is, we are going to take on the globalists. We're going to take back control of our country. We're going to do things that are in the interest of the American people, not in the interest of the elite few who believe that they are entitled to rule over us. And of course, Hillary Clinton perfectly represents those people. That's why conservatives like the National Review, the rest of the GOP establishment, are dumping on Trump. They would love to see Hillary Clinton. They are of the same cloth. They want the same things. Let's go to one of our callers here. Chris in Georgia, your comments about Donald Trump's speech today. Go ahead, Chris.
Hello, David. Thanks for your commitment to the InfoWar.
Well, thank you for calling. What's your comments?
I don't think exposing Hillary will change anything because most supporters will still say, at this point, what difference does it make? And I mean, I am the only Trump supporter in my neighborhood, and I asked my neighbors, would they vote for Hillary, even if she's indicted? And they said yes, because they say the news says Trump is bad, and that's the only source that they get their information from. So I don't think it'll change anything. But I think the ultimate way to get something changed is advertisement. If he gets his stuff on the TV, I think that would be the ultimate weapon towards Hillary Clinton.
Well, you know, that's interesting. The narrative, it's interesting that you bring that up because I was going to talk about that. For the last several days, we've seen this continuous narrative from the mainstream media. Trump just isn't a serious candidate because he doesn't have all this money. Think about it. We've heard for the longest time from these very people, we've got to get money out of politics. It's corrupting the political process. George W. Bush bought the election, and it's true. It's true. And the only way that you're going to do this is not with some kind of a phony control out of Washington. You got to get the power out of Washington. As long as you've got all this power in Washington, it is going to be a black hole drawing in money because these people who contribute to these politicians like Hillary Clinton can get thousands of percent return on their investment. They give them a little bit of money and they get tremendous amount of leverage in crony capitalism. We just talked last night about this massive new rail system that is being rammed down the throats of people in rural Texas going between Dallas and Houston. I mean, it is a prime example. It's the next level of crony capitalism. They keep taking it bigger and bigger with a Japanese company. But I think nobody gives Donald Trump credit for what he was able to do in the primaries. Certainly he is raising money now, and I think that's important. It is an information war. Stay with us. We're going to come back, take more of your calls. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. Of course, we had Alex call in and talk about this massive speech that Donald Trump did earlier today. We're going to have another couple of excerpts coming up here. We're going to take your calls as well. The last caller who called in was talking about how important it is for Donald Trump to get out his message with commercials. And I agree. But as I was saying, I think a lot of this narrative that we're seeing from the mainstream media has two parts to it. Number one, they're looking for anything that they can criticize Donald Trump on. They say, well, he hasn't raised money, therefore he's not a serious candidate. Seriously? Seriously? Look at the difference in the number of votes that Donald Trump has gotten versus any other Republican candidate. He's been able to bring people into the process that never voted before. He set a record number of votes. Millions more people voted in the Republican primaries than ever before for any Republican candidate. That's serious. That's a serious candidate. And he did it with the least amount of money. Remember, we were all supposed to be in shock and awe of Jeb Bush's $150 million, his war chest that he put together with Wall Street and foreign governments. And Donald Trump wiped the map with that $150 million shill, Jeb Bush. And I think he can do it with Hillary Clinton as well. But I think it's also very self-serving of the media, because the mainstream media is very upset about this. This is a huge, huge source of income for these people. Now, you know, if you remember back to the 2000 elections, George W. Bush was criticized for buying the election. He spent $200 million to get elected. That's nothing today. You got Obama raising this up to $1 billion. I mean, Hillary will easily spend over $1 billion now. And that is a measure not of what a serious candidate is. That is not a measure of the number of people behind them. That is a measure of the corruption of Washington. Because it's only a few people who are giving that money. Only a few people who can give that kind of money. It is a measure of how out of control and unaccountable the crony capitalism has become in Washington, D.C. So it is no badge of honor to raise tens or hundreds of millions of dollars from Wall Street and foreign governments. And that's what Donald Trump is talking about today. He called her out on that. He called her out on other crimes. And here's one of the, he's talked about crooked Hillary. He's talked about her being a world-class liar today. And here he is talking about corrupt Hillary from today's press conference.
Hillary Clinton gave China millions of jobs, and our best jobs, and effectively let China completely rebuild itself. In return, Hillary Clinton got rich. The book Clinton Cash by Peter Schweitzer documents how Bill and Hillary used the State Department to enrich their family and America's and at America's expense. She gets rich making you poor.
Right.
Here is a quote from the book. At the center of U.S. policy toward China was Hillary Clinton. At this critical time for U.S.-China relations, Bill Clinton gave her a number of speeches that were underwritten by the Chinese government and its supporters. These funds were paid to the Clintons' bank account directly while Hillary was negotiating with China on behalf of the United States. Tell me, folks, does that work? She sold out our workers and our country for Beijing. Hillary Clinton has also been the biggest promoter of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which will ship millions more of our jobs overseas and give up congressional power to an international foreign commission. Now, because I have pointed out why it would be such a disastrous deal, she's pretending that she's against it. She's given and deleted, as you know, and most people have heard about this. Have we ever heard about her deleting anything? No, I don't think so. She deleted the entire record from her book, and deletion is something she really does know something about because she's deleted at least 30,000 emails. Which, by the way, should be able to be found.
Yeah, he's absolutely right about that. She says, you know, she was supportive of Trans-Pacific Partnership, the Transatlantic Partnerships. Now she says she's against it. Look, Hillary Clinton's State Department pushed for the Keystone Pipeline harder than anybody in the Democrat Party did. Most of those in the Democrat Party didn't like it. They were worried about the environmental aspects of it. The Republican Party was supporting it because they wanted to get behind the oil industry. And it's a massive crony capitalism issue. It's a massive eminent domain issue, just like this railroad system that's going to be running from Dallas to Houston is. Giving a foreign corporation the right to come in and take your property. And that's why on so many of these issues, we see a net wash. You know, we talked about how Donald Trump was had used eminent domain, and yet all of the Republican candidates want to give eminent domain to a foreign corporation. But what's important, where the real difference is that he understands that the Trans-Pacific Partnership is going to destroy our sovereignty, and it is going to destroy our prosperity. And we know that she's for this. We know that the Castro brothers, one of them that's being touted as one of the front runners for her VP choices, he is his brother is touring Vietnam with Obama a week or two ago and pushing the Trans-Pacific Partnership. There's absolutely no doubt that Hillary is going to push this through, these globalist trade partnerships. There's absolutely no doubt that she's going to push that through, and he was absolutely right to oppose her on it. It is a key difference. This election, again, is about globalism versus nationalism. And whether or not you agree with Donald Trump on the individual liberty issues, there isn't a difference between him and the Democrats or anybody else that's running on the Republican side. The issue and the only choice that we have here is on the issue of globalism versus nationalism, on these trade treaties, on these open borders issues. And that's where the Republican establishment and the Democrat establishment are joined at the hip. And that is the difference with Donald Trump. That is the key issue. Let's talk to Rich in New Jersey. Rich, your comments.
Hey, David, how you doing? I just had a question for you. I want to see if this is a viable thing. I know in the 40s, UBC Bank, which was Prescott Bush and Herbert Walker were investing money for a guy named Thyssen, and they broke that bank up under the Doing Business with the Enemy Act. Now, if Saudi Arabia, since the war on terrorism is a war, if they're convicted or seen to be the ones jockeying 9/11, wouldn't it be possible to seize Hillary Clinton's finances and all her money based on the same principle?
If we were a just country, yes, of course it would be. The question is Hillary even going to be indicted by our government? That's a true issue. I mean, you're talking about breaking banks up. We've seen UBC and HSBC convicted repeatedly for money laundering of drug cartels and terrorists. They even gave the Sinaloa cartel. You know, everybody talked about El Chapo escaping and everything. Well, HSBC gave him his own personal window where they laundered money for him. What did they get? They got a slap on the wrist. Nothing happened to them. And it was the Obama administration said, hey, they're too big to jail. Remember Eric Holder saying that essentially? That was the summary of what he had to say. And it's absolutely true. That was their attitude. It doesn't do any good for us to lock up any of these bankers, and we don't want to revoke their charter. They wouldn't do anything to the people that were rigging the LIBOR exchange, the London interbank rates that everybody's home mortgage rates, especially if you got a variable rate mortgage. It's all based on the LIBOR exchange. These people were making billions rigging this market. So we've got all these bankers who are caught in all this criminal operation, and they keep getting away with it. So I think the most that we're going to be able to hope for out of this is an indictment of Hillary Clinton. I don't think we're going to get a conviction, and I don't think an indictment is going to make any difference to the people who support her. As the earlier caller said, he said, I talked to people about Hillary Clinton, and they don't really care. They don't really care that she violated the religion of the police state, national security. I mean, this is a person who committed sacrilege. It's like, you know, slaughtering a child on the altar or something, what she did with the emails. And yet she's going to get a pass. And they have to do, they're taking all of our freedoms for this national security state, and yet they're going to give Hillary Clinton a pass. So I don't really think they're going to do anything about it. Do you?
No, when you put it that way, unfortunately, I think you're right. It just seems we've fallen so far. But that would be a it would be, if this was the country that it's supposed to be, we would be able to do that, because if you have the Saudis bragging how much money they gave her, you know, I mean, it's clearly out in the open, too. It's just amazing. It's just amazing.
Well, you know, I honestly think that this is going to be a key election, because there's a lot in it. Hillary Clinton is the kind of person who is going to take reprisals against Donald Trump. You can bet on it. And he's not afraid to personally attack her, as we saw today. We knew this was going to happen. We knew that Donald Trump was not going to pull any punches like these other politicians did. And he has called these people on their globalist schemes. And he has exposed it. I mean, he's talked about the issues with vaccines and autism. He's talked about a lot of these different issues that other people wouldn't talk about. He talked about the 28 pages. We had people who were on the official conspiracy theory group, you know, the 9/11 commission. They talked about Saudi Arabia's connection in the original report that they put together. And yet you had these, it got redacted, and you got these people who were head of the Senate Intelligence Committee who for 15 years were trying to get this exposed. They couldn't get any traction on it at all until Donald Trump brought it up. So he's going to come out, and he's going to come out and not hold back on any of this stuff. And so I think it's very clear that if Donald Trump wins the election, there will probably be a criminal prosecution of Hillary Clinton or some of these other people. I think he will do something like that. And so for her, her back is against the wall. You know, it's the White House or the big house. For him, his back is also against the wall. He's in this now. He's in this. And the establishment is going to come after him with all their barrels loaded if he doesn't win. So this is really a do or die. You know, they say, you know, if you come after the king, you better get him, because you don't get a second chance. So this is, they both got a lot on the line here in this thing. So it's going to be a very, very difficult, very important election. I want to go to Matt in Oklahoma. But before we do, I just want to remind you again that we've extended the Tim Kennedy special. This is the last day. We've extended it one more day. That's 15% off of the products that Tim Kennedy tells us he found most effective in his training for UFC as well as Special Forces. He trains intensively. And he said, when I use Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12, I can really, really feel a difference. He mentioned that to Alex Jones. And so Alex put together a special. So, all right, we'll put those three out there. We'll offer them to people. Give them an opportunity to try these products at 15% off. See if they do for them what they did for Tim Kennedy. And, of course, you can read hundreds of five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com, people talking about the effect that these products have had, positive effect on them in their life. And we're offering that to you. We extended that for one more day. Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12, 15% off. That's the Tim Kennedy special at InfoWarsLife.com. Now let's go back to Matt in Oklahoma. Matt, you wanted to make a comment about Trump's speech today. Go ahead.
I did. Hey, Dave, longtime listener, daily watcher. I've also been like you, have kind of, you know, was on the fence about Trump. You know, at the first of the year, if I came forward and said, hey, you're going to like Trump at the end of the year, there's no way I would have believed that. I'm sure you probably felt the same way.
That's right.
Let me get to the points here. Okay, so like you said, it's globalism versus nationalism, which at its core is the individual under attack versus the collective.
Yes.
And what caused that was, like you said, NAFTA. NAFTA was the coffin. The TPP will be the lid they want to nail down on top of America. Now, we want to blame the corporations because they're the ones that, you know, buy out all the politicians. They buy the left and the right and rig the game before the plays are made on the field. And they already know the outcome. But then the people in the stands can say, that guy on the other side, I hate him because he likes this guy. Well, I like that guy. Now they're arguing about the game and they don't understand who fixed the game before the election. But it goes higher than that, because at the top of this pyramid is the Federal Reserve. We used to be a free nation, and in 1913 we were taken over by foreign bankers, and since then we've not been free. And in fact, to call the left and the right parties is actually incorrect. It should be the Democratic Corporation and the Republic Corporation.
Yes.
But what gets us in this direction is, you know, I was trying to explain this to my brother last night, and he doesn't understand a lot of these things, and he actually came up with a great analogy I wanted to share. Was, you know, the concept of trade is, you know, you used to have a gold coin, you'd go get an IOU note from the bank, and you could go get that gold coin back by giving them the paper back. But what happens if they took that, you know, currency, that piece of paper, and then made a photocopy of it? Then they took the photocopy and put that on top of the photocopy machine and made another copy and kept taking the copy of the copy and copying it over and over and over And now you have an explanation for the value of our currency.
That'd be called quantitative easing, wouldn't it?
Yes, indeed.
Exactly. Yeah, you're exactly right. And, you know, one of the things people need to understand, too, when we talk about this and we talk about the economic consequences, I think a lot of people don't realize that it was a package deal. When they created the Federal Reserve and they gave them control, they also created the income tax. And they created the income tax at the same time they started opening up and lowering tariffs, opening up our trade, calling it free trade. Okay, so before that, if we go all the way back to Thomas Jefferson, we had a situation where Thomas Jefferson bragged at the beginning of his second administration. He said, "We have eliminated all internal taxation." He says, "What person in America, what farmer, laborer, mechanic knows a tax man? None of them know a tax man. We support the government," and it was a small government. It was a constitutional-sized government. "We support the government strictly based on tariffs, on money coming into the country." And what did that do for us? Okay, that gave us a strong, internal, self-sufficient government. And what they did when they enacted, they did exactly the opposite thing when they put together the income tax, created the Federal Reserve, this all scheme of the bankers, and then opened up trade for us. They took down the trade barriers, they took down the tariffs, but then they put internal taxes on us. And we're at the extent right now where, as Donald Trump was pointing out, and he was being mocked in the debates by Marco Rubio, who wouldn't let him finish a sentence, Donald Trump kept saying, "Hey, they've got all these lines that they've drawn. They won't let competition for insurance companies go from state to state." And Marco Rubio goes, "Lines, lines, he's talking about lines." He was talking about the fact that we don't even have free trade in health insurance in America. That's how they have locked us down. That's what the crony capitalists, the banking companies, the insurance companies have done. They have destroyed free trade within our country. And yet they have opened it up. Why have they opened it up? Because they want to export jobs. They want to import workers. And so we need to understand that having tariffs is not the end of the world. You know, we always we hear this narrative that, you know, what created the Great Depression was tariffs at the borders. That's not true. And we even see the fear-mongering coming from George Soros saying, "Hey, you know, once before I got a hold of your currency and I dropped the pound 20% in a day." And I looked at that and I thought, well, you know, that's not really a bad thing, is it? Because one of the key advantages of China is their trade, their currency manipulation. And what do? They try to manipulate it to make their currency have an advantage trading with other people. And so if that were to happen, Britain would have an advantage. As a matter of fact, Japan's Abe is doing the same thing. They call it Abenomics. And he's trying to do the same sort of thing, which George Soros said he would do to the UK if they get out as a punishment. I would say, hey, bring it on. That's only going to make exports more affordable coming out of Britain, as well as building an independence and an economy within their country. Stay with us. We'll be right back with more of your calls. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to go back to your calls about Donald Trump's speech today in just one moment. Real quickly, I want to break down all these specials we've extended. Again, as I mentioned, the Tim Kennedy special, 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, 20% off Deep Cleanse. That's a new special that came out today. We still have the Alexa Pure water filters, 20% off all of the water filters from the largest system down to the shower filter. That's 20% off all Alexa Pure water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. And then there's the Hillary for Prison t-shirt, the t-shirt that sent Slate into fits. They wrote an entire article about a lady that they saw at the rally last Saturday who had been an Obama voter, and she's wearing a Hillary for Prison t-shirt. They flipped out and wrote an entire article about this and said, "Oh, I can't believe this. The right wing believes that Hillary is a crook." Imagine that. And so Donald Trump defined that today for us as to why she is a crook. But that Hillary for Prison t-shirt, you can get for 50% off the first t-shirt, 75% off for the second t-shirt. Send Slate and other people into hissy fits. Get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt now. It's a great time to get a huge discount off the Hillary for Prison. 50% off the first one, 75% off the second one. All right, let's go back to your phone calls. Steven in Ohio. Steven, go ahead.
Hey there, David. I'm a long-time listener, first-time caller.
Thank you.
I just wanted to talk about what I believe is going to happen here in the near future regarding the elections and having to do with the all these shootings and things, trying to restrict the Second Amendment and things. And also, I think that the shadow government, the Illuminati, the Bilderberg groups, whoever you want to call them, the New World Order, the globalists, will do anything that they can to prevent Donald Trump from winning the presidency, whether that has to do with assassination.
I agree. We saw that in the Brexit vote. I absolutely agree. They'll pull out all the strings. And that's one of the reasons why I really have come around to supporting Donald Trump. As I said, it's about globalism versus nationalism. And that is a key issue for individual liberty. And it is also the fact that we see how much the establishment of both the Democrats and Republicans hate him. I mean, that is a badge of honor, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And you know what? The reason why they're doing all of this, the reason why, with the 9/11 false flag attacks, all these false flag shootings and stuff, calling for restrictions, take away the guns and everything, it's because they're scared. They're afraid. They know that we know the truth.
Yes.
And they're afraid that we're going to rise up against them. And I think that the Federal Reserve, the globalists, the big bankers and all of that, I think that they are going to implode the economy and causing upset and discord across the entire U.S. And I think they're going to use this orchestrated plot to invoke martial law and suspend the elections.
Well, I can tell you that if they get these, trade agreements together, they don't really even need martial law to take our economy down, because they will have the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the Transatlantic Partnership. They will be able to manage our economy, the world economy, not only ours, but Europe and all these Asian nations. They will be able to manage those economies without any input from the people. These are trade agreements that were written in secret by these multinational corporations. It will establish a committee that is unanswerable to us, and it will be a tyranny that we will not be able to get out of without having a war, and that's for certain. That's why this is such a key election. That's why this issue of nationalism versus globalism is so important, and Donald Trump is the only one to oppose it. Hang on with your calls. We'll take some more calls as we come back in the first 5 minutes. We're going to have Rob Dew talking to someone who was a Venezuelan protester who exposed what was going on in Venezuela and has a lot to say about what happened in the UK with Muslims there as he immigrated from Venezuela. Stay with us for the fourth hour and Rob Dew as well. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. Rob Dew is going to be joining us in the next segment. He's going to be hosting the rest of the hour. He's going to be talking to someone who is added to the cyber terrorism list in Venezuela. Eventually got out of there, immigrated to the UK, and has much to say about the effects of mass migration and what happened to him in the UK with the Muslims that were coming into the UK. So he's going to be interviewing that person in the fourth hour. I want to try to get through as many of these calls as we can. Let's go to John in Oklahoma. John, go ahead.
Yes, I know that a lot of this Donald Trump is looking at getting from a sort of a top-down perspective, but I'd like to see you get Sheriff Mack back on. That's sort of from a bottom-up perspective. I have kind of some doubts if we can fix this thing from the top down.
Oh, I agree, but absolutely.
Bottom up, but we.
And I said from the very, I've said throughout this campaign, when you look at individual liberty, I don't see anybody offering that running at the top. And so I think it's very important for us to keep liberty from getting even more difficult for us. Look, if we lose our country, if we lose even the lip service to the Constitution, we really are messed up, okay, at that point. But I agree that the fight for individual liberty is going to be won at the local level. And I think it's really important to elect the right people as sheriffs. They have a tremendous amount of power. If you get the right sheriff in there, they can do a tremendous amount. Sheriff Mack shut down the Brady Bill. And as we're looking at gun control coming back now, understand that it was the NRA, it was Ronald Reagan, it was George Bush, it was Bill Clinton, all of them pushed through the Brady Bill, and it was Sheriff Mack, a local sheriff in conjunction with other sheriffs, who took it to the Supreme Court and said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to shut that down, even over the NRA. So it's very important to get good people at the local level to stand with you and to stand up for their rights. Look, we have a constitution. We know that they don't obey this constitution they take an oath to, but they appeal to it for their authority. And we can point to that and say, if you deny this document that you take an oath to when you take your office, then you don't have any legitimate authority. So I absolutely agree with you, John. We need to get very involved at the local level. It's hard for us to do that as a national organization. We pull people in occasionally to talk about that, but that's something that each of you has to do most of your research on your own to find out what's going on, who the individuals are in your area that can help you. We can do that to a limited extent, but it's difficult for us to do that because we have a national and an international broadcast. But that is really, I think, where the rubber is going to meet the road in individual liberty. Thank you, John. Let's go quickly to Margaret in Oklahoma. Go ahead, Margaret.
Hello?
Hey, you're on. Go ahead.
Hello. I think that President Trump is going to have his hands full rooting out corruption in our corrupt justice system. There's a young man in Alaska that the FBI was trying to get him to agree to a plot to murder people, and he said no. And this is Schaefer Cox, and he said no, and it's on tape that he said no. Then the FBI, the jury was not allowed to hear that he said no, and they were not allowed to hear that it was the FBI plot, and so they sent him to prison for 26 years.
Yeah,
that was 5 years ago.
We've seen that a lot, and again, I think that is not something that a President Trump is going to do. Quite honestly, we're going to have to reclaim the understanding of jury nullification, and we're going to have to get that back. And it's a catch 22 because so many people have lost the idea of juries that they will plea bargain. You know, the tactic that the government uses, besides using false informants and tricking people and entrapping them, they also bring up all kinds of bogus charges, hoping that you'll plea to one other charge. So they give you, you know, a whole slew of charges, say, well, we'll take away some of these bogus charges, but you plead guilty to this. And most people will take that deal. And we've talked to individuals. We talked to the New Jersey weed man who had to represent himself because most lawyers will not argue for jury nullification, even though it is in most state constitutions, even though it is a principle that our country was founded upon, a principle that was even established back in English common law. Those types of things, we're going to have to take that back at the local level. It's going to be sheriffs. It's going to be informed juries. It's going to take some hard groundwork at the grassroots level. We're not going to be able to elect a savior that's going to take care of this. He's going to have too many things on his plate. But what he can do is he can take care of things where we are losing our sovereignty at the national and international level. Stay with us. Rob Dew is going to be right back with this person who was persecuted in Venezuela.
Welcome to the fourth hour of Overdrive. This is Rob Dew reporting for Infowars.com. I'm the news director at PrisonPlanet.tv, and it's always my pleasure to bring you the latest news and analysis here in the fourth hour. And hats off to David Knight for taking over, sitting in for Alex Jones, who's getting a well-deserved vacation, even though he still is, I guess there's just too much news for him to stay silent. He's still filing reports. He was talking to me earlier. We had videos that were throwing around, putting stuff up. It's wild and crazy here at the InfoWars Central Texas Command Center. I want to go over a couple articles here, just some basic stuff that's going on InfoWars, and also talk about a guest I have coming up. Back on June 9th, we posted a article called "This Video Will Get Donald Trump Elected If It Goes Viral." That was produced by one John Aquaviva, who is a Venezuelan who now lives in England. And he produced this video. It's got 1.5 million views right now. And it's just basically, clips of Donald Trump talking on the Ronna Barrett show, Oprah Winfrey at the GOP convention, C-SPAN, CNN interview, Larry King Live, Steve Forbes, just all these events in the past leading up to where he is now and kind of laying the groundwork. I mean, maybe Donald knew he was going to run for president back in the 80s and just didn't want to tell anybody. It was probably smart because then I guess they would have started. He would have automatically been a racist back then, you know, because that's what happens, I guess, when you run for office and you have Democratic Party operatives. Of course, that was the party that started the KKK. And also you have Hillary Clinton, who was a known friend to Senator Robert Byrd, who was a grand wizard of the Ku Klux Klan back in West Virginia. And Bill Clinton also praised him at his funeral. So, but that's okay because they're liberal Democrats and they love you. They really do. They care about you. That's why they lie to you consistently, tell you that you're going to get something for free when you're not. And also, here's an article that Darren McBreen passed over to me from the New York Times. Goodbye password. Banks opt to scan fingers and faces instead. This is something Alex Jones told you about 15 years ago, that this was going to come. They're going to go to this biometric technology. In fact, he showed it back in his first film. What is his first film called? I want to say Police State 2000. America Destroyed by Design. America Destroyed by Design. He travels the country. He ends the whole video by getting arrested, going to get his driver's license renewed when they want him to thumb scan. And he says, look, this is part of a whole new biometric system where first it's the thumb, then they're going to want to take your blood, then they're going to get an iris scan. It's all happening to buy and sell, to get a job. Here it is. Some of the nation's largest banks acknowledging that traditional passwords are either too cumbersome or no longer secure are increasingly using fingerprints, facial scans, and other types of biometrics to safeguard accounts. So it's coming. Bank of America, JP Morgan Chase, and Wells Fargo routinely use fingerprints along their bank accounts through their mobile phones. So it's coming. Get ready. It's something we warned you about. And pretty soon we won't be able to drive our cars. We won't be able to do anything. And robots are going to take care of us. And we're going to live like those fat people in WALL-E, you know, riding around sipping our giant, ultra, mega, huge, big ass fries and big gulps. Well, let's look at these two articles. That was InfoWars coffee, by the way. It's really good. You ought to check it out, InfoWarsStore.com. Really wakes you up and gets you pumped. All right, here's an article from Kit Daniels. Trump: Hillary takes millions from anti-gay, anti-women regimes, wants Sharia migrants. And this is based off the Trump speech that is all over the internet, taking the nation by storm, and the Democrats are trying to figure out how they stop somebody who's actually telling the truth. I only want to admit people who share our values and love our people. But Hillary Clinton wants to bring in people who believe that women should be enslaved and gays should be put to death, he said in a speech in New York on Wednesday. Maybe her motivation lies among the 1,000 foreign donations Hillary failed to disclose while at the State Department. Oh, don't want to talk about that, do you, Clinton? She accepted $58,000 in jewelry from the government of Brunei when she was Secretary of State, plus millions more for her foundation. The Sultan of Brunei has pushed oppressive Sharia law, including the punishment of death by stoning for being gay. The government of Brunei also stands to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of Hillary's Trans-Pacific Partnership, which she absolutely would approve if given the chance. And there's more in there. You can read it all at InfoWars.com. It's by Kit Daniels. And here's an article we have posted, but it's from Information Liberation. Watch as Calais migrants riot chant, F the UK, demand access to Britain. So F it, we hate it, but we want to get in there because we like what you've done. We like what Western freedom has brought and the prosperity has brought. Now we just want to take it over, and we think you owe us. Families reported being stuck in the chaos all day as gangs of migrants attacked the causeway in waves, hurling rocks and other projectiles at cars and breaking into lorries. In case you don't know what a lorry is, it's a big truck that they like to, and there's plenty of videos of that. So Breitbart has some of the tweets there from people. I guess they're tweets, or people have been posting in. Yeah, it is from tweets. Been stuck in Calais for 12 hours. I've watched migrants throw bricks at cars, drive into water by ferries, and run into Le Shuttle. Chaos, tweeted a British journalist. I can assure you what is being reported as a power outage is the actually violence and chaos from migrants fighting here. Here's another. Still stuck in Calais after day and night with migrants fighting with police, tear gas being used, and a five-mile-long queue. Chaotic. So it's all happening. Meanwhile, you got Hillary Clinton running around telling people Trump is going to ruin the economy if he gets elected. I actually have Trump's the Tax Policy Center analyzed his tax plan, and they said it would significantly reduce marginal tax rates on individuals and businesses and increase standard deduction amounts nearly four times to the current level and may curtail many tax expenditures, and it would cut incomes at all level. They do say the largest benefits will go to those making the highest amounts, but it would increase federal tax revenues by $9.5 trillion in its first decade. But he would have to actually have considerable spending cuts in order to counteract those tax increases. Or it will put more people to work and more businesses would hire more people and you would have more taxes to go from because more people would be employed. Currently, we have something like 20 to 30, even to 50 million people not being employed right now or underemployed under this current awesome Obama economy that has failed to grow by 3% and the only president to ever do that. But that's okay. I'm just a conspiracy theorist. Hey, guys, did we find the Kit Daniels video? I want to go to that if possible in this break, but we might not have time. Uh, All righty. So I guess we might go to that later. I do want to play John Bowne's video, which we're going to play in the next segment. And it is the Clintons, the real racists. I just kind of went over a smattering of how she's a bit racist. She's also said some interesting things while she was in the White House, which are being reported by a former Secret Service agent. So when we come back in that next short segment, we're going to play that, and we're going to have our interview with John Acquaviva. And he's going to be able to comment on what's going on in Venezuela, which will soon be coming here. First, it's going to hit Europe, and it's going to hit here. How basically their socialist utopia is just burning down in flames because, you know, they weren't able to account for the price of oil, and they can't steal any more people's property anymore because they've done Stalin on. They don't know how to run it because governments don't know how to run much of anything except run countries into the ground. So we'll talk about that. He's in Britain right now, so we'll probably talk a little bit about Brexit and why he supports Donald Trump and why he isn't afraid of somebody who's been a businessman and who's failed at businesses. He's had businesses that have gone bankrupt, and, you know, he's brought himself back. He's now richer than ever by not stopping and crying on his sleeve or asking for the government to help him out. So here it is from a couple days ago. This was on Fox News. Hillary Clinton's amazing, almost comical economic speech. And she starts off by stating the patently obvious. People are working harder and longer just to keep their heads above water and to deal with costs, the everyday costs, the costs of like basic child care, prescription drugs that are too high. Well, that's because you're Obamacare. College is getting more expensive. Well, that's because you've basically subsidized college for everybody. And wages are still low and inequality is too great. Good jobs in this country are still too hard to come by. And then she lectures us about fiscal responsibility. And even though the Obama administration has doubled the national debt to $19 trillion, he's doubled it in 8 years. So that's not too hard. It's hard for somebody to sit there and talk about being fiscally responsible when she's been part of that by being Secretary of State. And, of course, she talks about class warfare, which is something she loves and loves to propagate. People don't understand this. The reason you're poor, this world offers you plenty of advantages to get out. This world offers you plenty of opportunities, okay? If you don't have internet, you can go to the library and get internet. You can educate yourself by learning how to read. The world is at your fingertips. And if you are not able to rise to the level you want to be at, you really only have one person to blame. You could blame your parents, but then that's passing the buck. You only can look in the mirror and blame yourself. Point that finger right at yourself in the mirror and say, I got to do better. Okay? Nobody gave me this job here at InfoWars. I had to earn it. And I rose through the ranks from coming here. When I started working, I was making, I think, $15 or $16 an hour when I started. And I rose up through by showing I could be dependable, by showing I showed up on time, by showing I could be flexible in how things are, by showing I could be conscious. All these things help you. And I'm speaking to the young people out there that are crying in their beers right now that they can't get a real job because they've got two or three college degrees. You only have yourself to blame, okay? And it's not your fault entirely. You believed in the system. You believed in what these talking heads on TV have told you. The people who are, you know, the people who are more successful are the guys that went out and just decided to be a plumber or decided to get a landscaping company and work really hard. I did all that too. I worked on a farm for a year. I built houses for a summer. I learned about how to do things with my hands because when you learn how to do things with your hands, then nobody can take those skills away from you. And then you can realize and you're empowered to realize that you can do anything you want and nobody can stop you. But don't let the globalists tell you that because they won't. They will stop you any chance they get because they want you to be a slave and they want to take your energy. We'll be right back with more coming up with a video about how the Clintons are the real racists out there and it's not Donald Trump. Oh, tell your liberal friends to tune in. Infowars.com/show. We'll be right back with the fourth hour. This is Rob Due reporting. If you go to my Twitter account, at Due's News, I just posted a tweet that I was going live on Infowars.com/show where incidentally you can watch the free stream. So if you're listening to this, you can actually watch the video we're about to play, which is how the Clintons are the real racist. But one of the people that replied, Benjamin at hashtag vote leave, put a couple, or the one right before it, T. Murphy, put a couple videos up there about Brexit. So I didn't get a chance to watch them, but I looked at the titles. They look pretty good. One of which, I think David Cameron was telling people, be fearful if you vote leave and let fear be your guide. Fear should never be your guide. It should always be love. Just remember that. And one person we do love around here, we love to hate, is Hillary Clinton. And we have the Hillary for Prison t-shirt, which they Slate wrote about in just, I guess it came out today, talking about how they couldn't believe people were wearing these Hillary for Prison t-shirts. And how could people want the lady running for president to be put in prison and that she deserved it? Well, she does deserve it. Her crimes are legion, and we should at least put her on trial. Right now, they're 50% off for one, and you can get the next for 75% off. Can you believe that? 50% and 75%? It's 125% off for two. There you go. Buy one for yourself and get a second. 75% off. Get one for a friend, family, or coworker. Let everybody you know that Hillary Clinton deserves to be in prison. This is a meme that we've been working on for a long time, and it's finally gaining steam. It was going viral back in May, and it kind of went down. Now it's back up again because it's now Hillary versus Trump. And without further ado, let's go to John Bounds' report on the Clintons, the real racists.
Why would you support a racist?
He's
going to send you back to Africa. That's what he said.
He said
send Mexicans back to Mexico. You are a disgrace to America.
Thank you.
For being a young black man supporting a racist.
Thank you.
Donald Trump, what's it say?
I think he's a racist.
Come on, tell us why you think Trump's a racist.
We want to talk about the details, man.
Yeah.
What about the facts? How come you guys can only say he's a racist, but y'all can't talk about the facts? Why is that?
His opponents say that this is more proof that he's racist. And, you know, people say, is this racism? Because it sounds to me like you want to bring back the one drop rule.
Yeah.
Criminals and rapists.
No, he said that the criminals were coming over, which is a fact.
Is it?
I mean, some have come over, yes. So why should I be put into that category? Why should I be looked at as a bad person because I like guns?
Are you? Does media do that to you as a white male?
Of course. Oh, I'm the white man thing.
Oh, you are, aren't you?
Yeah. Got good eyes.
Does anyone on the left actually care about racism? Or is it just being used as a Zelensky-esque tool to polarize the sheep into bleeding what they have been told is true? Because according to Dolly Kyle, the former high school girlfriend of Bill Clinton, Bill and Hillary Clinton regularly used racial epithets and looked down on poor people. Kyle makes the accusation in her book, Hillary, the Other Woman. In addition to calling mentally disabled children at a governor's mansion Easter egg hunt effing retards, Kyle says Hillary referred to the people of Arkansas as ignorant hillbillies. Hillary also allegedly used derogatory terms for Jews, including effing Jew bastard. Bill, Kyle insists, called the Reverend Jesse Jackson a GD N-word. Latinos were similarly slandered and profiled. Kyle continues, for no good reason, Bill and Hillary decided to profile Hispanics as drug dealers. Specifically, Arkansas troopers were to stop and search cars driven by Hispanics, especially those cars with Texas license plates. Clinton's criminal apprehension program was ruled unconstitutional. Kyle continues, Billy threw one of his infamous temper tantrums about the ban on his racial profiling of Hispanics, and he threatened to renew the racial profiling program in spite of the court's ruling. The Daily Beast notes, Clinton's Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act of 1994, authored by then-Senator Joe Biden, was supported by virtually every Democrat in Congress, including then-Representative Bernie Sanders. That legislation led to the mass incarceration of black Americans. Legal scholar Michelle Alexander notes, Bill Clinton presided over the largest increase in federal and state prison inmates of any president in American history. Alexander accused the Clintons of decimating black America and said Hillary does not deserve the black vote. In response to pressure by Black Lives Matter, Hillary apologized for her role in pushing for the bill. Despite Hillary's alleged racism, a large number of blacks, especially in the South, turned out to vote for Clinton during the primaries. The Huffington Post notes, both Clinton and her husband, former President Bill Clinton, have traditionally had solid support from blacks, a key component of the Democratic electorate. In May, a Fox News poll revealed 62% of Latino...
All right, you can watch the rest of that video on the Alex Jones Channel or our YouTube. Bring that up, guys. It's the Clinton's the Real Racist right there. It's from John Bound. Also, report, released criminal aliens committed 10 times more crimes than the Obama administration told Congress. Who's right?
Political presidential talk to me. And I know people have talked to you about whether or not you want to run. Would you ever?
Probably not.
But I do get tired of seeing the country ripped
off. Why would you not?
I just don't think I really have the inclination to do it. I love what I'm doing. I really like it.
Also, it doesn't pay as well.
No, it doesn't. But, you know, I just probably wouldn't do it, Oprah. I probably wouldn't, but I do get tired of seeing what's happening with this country. And if it got so bad, I would never want to rule it out totally, because I really am tired of seeing what's happening with this country, how we're really making other people live like kings, and we're not.
You said, though, that if you did run for president, you believe you'd win.
Well, I don't know. I think I'd win. I tell you what, I wouldn't go in to lose. I've never gone into losing in my life. And if I did decide to do it, I think I'd be inclined. I would say that I would have a hell of a chance of winning, because I think people, I don't know how your audience feels, but I think people are tired of seeing the United States ripped off. And I can't promise you everything, but I can tell you one thing. This country would make one hell of a lot of money from those people that for 25 years have taken advantage. It wouldn't be the way it's been, believe me.
But you might be classified as an Eastern Republican. Fair?
I guess you could say that, yes.
Which means kind of a Rockefeller, Chase Manhattan Republican.
I never thought of one of those terms.
How do you define it? Are you a Bush Republican?
No, I think I'm really, the people that I do best with are the people that drive the taxis. You know, wealthy people don't like me because I'm competing against them all the time, and they don't like me, and I like to win. The fact is, I go down the streets of New York, and the people that really like me are the taxi drivers and the workers, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I really get
it. Why are you a Republican?
I have no idea. I mean, I am a Republican because I just believe in certain principles of the Republican Party.
You have flirted with the idea of politics. Now you're here at your...
And that is why they call him the blue-collar billionaire, because he resonates with blue-collar people. He's a likable guy. He's an everyman. And that's why the establishment on both sides hate him, because he's not an elitist. He, you know, there's stories of him going into kitchens of his restaurants and passing out $100 bills to his staff. And it's more than one story. And that's because he likes the people that work for him. And when he hires people and they're loyal, he returns that in kind. And a couple of things he said right there, just in that short video, and I'll get to the name of that video in a second. He says, talking about living like kings and how he's tired of the American people getting ripped off. He said that back in 1989. It's like 15 years ago he was saying that. And it's still true today. What does he talk about in his speech? He's tired of America being second. He wants the American people to be first in the eyes of America and not being treated as second-class citizens. And you can watch that whole video. You go to this article here. This video will get Donald Trump elected if it goes viral. We put this out on June 9th. Alex was talking about it. It was big back then. It got over 1,100 comments on Infowars.com. 27-minute video, and it's got 1,500,000 views as of this point. A little bit over that. All right, and our next guest actually created this video. His name's John Acquaviva, and he's not even an American, okay? He was born in Venezuela. He left Venezuela back in 2014. He was forced from Venezuela because he was added to the cyber terrorism list by the government. Because he incited violence on social media platforms, is what the government said. Probably because he said, hey, we shouldn't be living like animals and the government shouldn't own everything. And, of course, they took his family's land, and it's still being abandoned today. And I'm going to let him talk about that. And now he's living in Britain. So he'll have a pretty good idea from an outsider's point of view of what people are talking about in Brexit. Because sometimes you get a different point of view from somebody who's living there than somebody who's an actual citizen of there than somebody who's living there, but who's politically savvy and knows what's going on. Sometimes the people living there don't even know what's going on. You know, you go to your own country here. How many people does Mark Dice interview of American citizens who think... You could just go watch some of the Mark Dice videos that we should ban water, or that I can't think of some of his more classic videos. But, you know, these are citizens living in our own country and think the Bill of Rights should be abolished, among other things. Anyway, his name is John Acquaviva, and we're going to have him on in 1 second. We're hooking up his Skype connection now. But before we get to him, today is the last day of the Tim Kennedy special. 15% off Supermail Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. And I used all three of these at different points. I don't use Supermail as much because I'm not in a workout mode right now, but I use Secret 12. I use Secret 12 and Brain Force both on my trip to Bilderberg. And actually, the morning I took Secret 12 was the actual day I chased down Petraeus. where I had my backpack full of gear. It was so hot, I had taken off my jacket and had that folded inside my backpack. And I'm doing an interview with this other guy who's handing me flyers of all of his stuff. And I'm interviewing him as he's getting hassled by the police for writing on chalk. And I see Petraeus jog by and I'm like, gotta go. That's the guy I'm looking for. And I started asking him a question about, he had to resign because of his email server getting hacked or his emails getting hacked. And how come Hillary hasn't had to resign? It's been proven her email server's been hacked numerous times. Who knows who has all these secrets? Trump brought that out. We don't even know what the enemy knows because she deleted all those emails. So Trump's the guy who wants to put America first. Hillary is a witch who wants to put the Saudi Arabian kingdom first. We know that because those are the people that are paying her off. And so anyway, go to InfoWarsLife.com. Check out the Tim Kennedy special. It's the last day it's going on. Super Male Vitality. It's our biggest seller. Brain Force and Secret 12. Brain Force, you've heard me talk about it over and over again. Also, Deep Cleanse, 20% off. And then we have the amazing Hillary for Prison t-shirts. The first one, you get 50% off. The second one, 75%. Might as well get three or four. Pass them out. Give them as pre-Christmas gifts. Give them as 4th of July gifts, okay? Wear your shirts proud, because when you wear that shirt, people will notice. It's a great conversation starter. You'll find like-minded people immediately. Even if they're not Trump fans, hey, you can all be anti-Hillary fans. In fact, part of Donald Trump's speech that he had was appealing to Bernie Sanders voters and just saying, hey, look, join our movement. We're anti-establishment. We're by the people. I'm not spending $1 billion on it. People want to talk about how Trump doesn't have all this money in his campaign. He doesn't need to put as much money because, one, he's got the truth on his side, so he doesn't have to pay as much for his lies. And two, he knows how to work these idiots in the mainstream media to where they talk about him and talk about him incessantly. They were talking about his speech, or not even his speech, in on Fox News, just one of the things he tweeted for 20 minutes. That's free airtime, folks. That's how he's getting it done, which my hat's off to him. He's getting the media to talk about him. I wonder how they're going to talk about this Hillary speech, especially MSNBC, if they're even going to bring it up. They'll probably pretend it didn't exist. Do we have John on the line now? Okay. Well, I just talked to him on this number in here. Maybe we'll just pipe him in through the cell phone. And it seemed to be working. But we're going to get him on. Let's play that Bernie Sanders clip, how he was appealing, just basically saying, hey, look, you know, you're not going to vote for Hillary. You might as well come on over to the Trump side and help make America great again. Here's that clip.
The insiders wrote the rules of the game to keep themselves in power and in the money. That's why we're asking Bernie Sanders voters to join our movement so together we can fix the system for all Americans so important. This includes fixing all of our many disastrous trade deals, and they are disastrous. They're destroying our country because it's not just the political system that's rigged. It's the whole economy. It's rigged by big donors who want to keep wages down. It's rigged by big businesses who want to leave our country, fire our workers, and sell their products back into the United States with absolutely no consequences for them. It's rigged by bureaucrats who are trapping kids in failing schools. It's rigged against you, the American people. Hillary Clinton, and as you know, most people know, she's a world-class liar. Just look at her pathetic email server statements or her phony landing. Or her phony landing in Bosnia, where she said she was under attack, and the attack turned out to be young girls handing her flowers. A total and look, this was one of the buttes. A total and self-serving lie. Brian Williams' career was destroyed for saying
all right,
less.
So remember that. That's exactly right. And we played a little bit more. You got a little extra Trump in there, and we were doing some war gaming. We had John Skype, and then it kept dropping, and he's not answering his phone. So he may not join us this segment. We got a few minutes left in here. And I was hoping we get to interview him to get his perspective on Venezuela, the Brexit, and also talk about why it took somebody who wasn't even American to try to wake up America. Because, you know, a lot of people have been woken up. And, you know, it's funny that the establishment is so mad they've created all these lies. I think the Huffington Post says on every article about Trump, they're like, this man is a racist, sexist, xenophobe. They just come up and they put it on every article. Because they can't stand that somebody who's not an establishment darling, somebody who isn't bought and paid for, who isn't going to keep things as they are, is running for president. They're so mad and they believe in the lies so much. They just love it. And here's one of the other lies that they love to talk about, how Hillary is a friend of the gays and the lesbian community and women. Yet she takes money from all these Saudis and all these other Middle Eastern countries who treat women as second-class citizens, who throw gays off buildings, who openly proclaim the gays should have their heads cut off. And whether you believe in that lifestyle or not isn't of my concern. You're not out there saying they should be killed and have their heads cut off. And you don't have to believe in that lifestyle. That's what makes America great, is that you don't have to agree with somebody else. But we have this land, and there's plenty of land for everybody, and we can have room for everybody. Now, after the events in Orlando, a Houston gun shop decided to give free gun safety lessons and gun courses to the LGBT community. And we so happen to have our reporters Kit Daniels and Michael Zimmerman driving from Dallas from a Trump event to Houston. And this is in the northern part of Houston, up I think in the Woodlands. We said, hey, go interview this guy. Let's see what he's talking. Let's get the story straight from the horse's mouth, unfiltered, uncensored, bringing you the news. All thanks to our PrisonPlanet.tv supporters and those who go to InfoWarsLife.com. So here's the article. This video will stop gun control if it goes viral. And this gun shop owner reveals how you can win support for the Second Amendment. And that's you out there, the collective you. Okay, because we all need our Second Amendment. Let me tell you, if they take away our Second Amendment, everything else is on the line. Everything else is going to fall. Okay, and you will become a slave. The only reason we aren't in chains at this point and living like sheep over in Europe, because let me tell you, the people of Europe think they're free. There's no freedom in Europe. These are kept people. And I feel bad because there are a lot of good people in Europe and they know what freedom is, but they don't get to experience it because they aren't allowed to protect themselves. You can't even have pepper spray in Germany. That's against the law. Any form of protecting yourself is against the law, and you think the cops are going to protect you. No, the cops were protecting the elites. They were behind fences protecting the elites who are having their secret meeting. So let's go to that interview now. This is Kit Daniels.
Kit Daniels here with InfoWars.com in Houston, Texas, outside the Shiloh Gun Archery Range. Now, this gun store recently made headlines for offering free CHL classes for the gay community after the Orlando shooting. And what was unexpected was the sheer volume of people who are interested in the classes. They've had hundreds of hundred people that signed up for the classes. Their phone lines have completely jammed. Their voicemails got full. So let's talk to the owner and find out more.
My name is Jeff Sanford. I'm the general manager here at Shiloh Indoor Shooting Range in Northwest Houston. We're a family-owned and operated shooting range.
Okay, what kind of classes are you offering for the gay community right now?
Well, we're doing a free license to carry class for the LGBT community because one of our customers and good friends of ours, his name is Ryan Thomas, and we were speaking to him after Orlando happened and wanted to know, you know, I said, hey, man, I know you carry, but we'd like to do something for your friends. And he was really distraught about it. And seeing as it was in Orlando and so far away, I personally didn't understand why he was so distraught. And then he explained to me that, you know, hey, these places are places that they feel like they can go anytime, and that's the one place that they can feel totally safe. So even though it happens states away from us, it's affecting the community here tremendously as well. And so I said, well, man, let's do something for your friends. So tell some of your friends, we'll give them a free license to carry class. And we thought that would be maybe one or two classes with 30 or 40 people total, and so far today, about 2 days after we announced it, we're at either approaching or just past 300 students signed up. What was supposed to be one or two classes is now 10 classes and about to open an 11th.
So what kind of public response did you get from this when you announced the class?
Most of the response has been really, really overwhelmingly positive. You know, there's a few detractors, but you can't do anything without having at least a few detractors. And, you know, it's been outstanding. We've had veterans that have called and said, hey, we want to come up and provide security for your classes. We have police officers that are off duty, spending their off duty time up here, volunteering their time to come up and provide security for the classes. I've had license to carry instructors from all over the state giving me a call saying, hey, man, I'll be more than happy to come up. I'll do anything from teaching the entire class to just pushing brass around the range when they're done shooting. We've had a tremendous amount of goodwill from the shooting community as a whole. I think everybody realizes that this is a golden opportunity for us to take what has been a small percentage of our population at, you know, maybe 3.8% and really bring them into our world. You know, they have not felt safe to be able to come to a place like a shooting range. And while we may think, why wouldn't you feel safe to go to a shooting range? You know, we're great people here. You know, we like to be friends with everybody. The fact is that I've talked to 300 people and none of them, they've all told me the same thing. We've never felt like that's the kind of place that we would belong. And so we've put this off and put it off, but now we can actually do it. So this is a golden opportunity for us as gun owners, as Second Amendment advocates, to say, hey, come join us, be part of what we do, and have an entire new range of Second Amendment advocates out there for us. 3.8% of the population takes legislation from a minor loss to a tremendous overwhelming victory if we can get that 3.8% and bring them into our world of self-defense and self-preservation.
Have you had some people that showed up for the classes that never shot a gun before?
Almost all of them. That's been the thing. You know, out of the nearly 300 people that have signed up, out of all the ones that I've talked to, I think I've got maybe 10 that have their own firearm and have experience with a firearm. So we're trying to do our part to make sure that, you know, when they get their license to carry, you know, part of the license to carry is doing a shooting qualification. So we've got everybody coming.
There you go. And you can watch the rest of that video on. This video is going to make the gun control. I forget the title of it, but it's about, can y'all pull it back up again? Anyway, that's 3.8% is 12 million people. All right. This video will stop gun control if it goes viral. Hey, get your friends out there in the LGBT community. Get them armed. Get them shooting. Let's take this country back with a peaceful restoration of our republic. Rob Dew with Infowars.com. We'll be right back with one more segment. Rob Dew with the final segment of the fourth hour of Overdrive. It has been my pleasure to be with you this last hour. And remember, you can always watch video, the live video stream, Infowars.com/show. Or if you're not getting this on your local radio station, tell them to pick up the fourth hour. The more people that hear this message will tune in and the more people will spread the word. Just like we play this video of the gun shop owner giving out free gun classes to LGBT members. Okay. Just think if every gun shop did that, we'd have so many more people empowered, walking around, practicing the Second Amendment, who wouldn't be afraid of guns, who wouldn't be calling for more gun control. Remember Joe Biggs went to Orlando? People were still calling for gun control. Even though, how did they stop that guy? Oh, they stopped him with a gun. Wow. It's amazing how that happens. And it's funny, the people that want gun control don't really want the government to not have guns. I've tweeted out pictures yesterday. Hillary Clinton surrounded by people with guns. Okay, she thinks they're great when she's surrounded by people with guns. She wouldn't want those people to be taken away. Now, I want to stress, today is the last day. Last day, we extended it one extra day for that Tim Kennedy special. 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. It is the true Patriot Pack. There it is right there. Super Male, Brain Force, Secret 12. You know, I like to say Brain Force, it's like windshield wipers for your brain. All right, you're got a dirty windshield. That's kind of your brain all fogged up. You take Brain Force. It just wipes your brain clean. And it clears everything up. I don't know how it does it. I'm not a chemist. All I know is that it works. I take it anytime I feel like I need that extra. Or if I didn't get enough sleep that night. And I've seen emails from people. Oh, I got 4 hours of sleep. I took Brain Force. Boom. I was awake. There's a commercial out there where I was editing the Louis Farrakhan interview. Didn't get to work on it all week. I had to stay here and pull an all-nighter, and I did it with Brain Force. Let me tell you, it's not like coffee where you get the jitters. I came in here earlier, I have my InfoWars Life coffee and it really pumps me up, but it's like a almost a psychotic urge where you just want to get in there and tear people apart. But BrainForce is a lot more calming. It's a lot more, I'm super focused and I'm ready to take on the New World Order. So get your Tim Kennedy special today, InfoWarsLife.com. These are the products that Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training. In fact, I think he's going for the middleweight championship coming up. Should be interesting to see if he's able to take it. He trains like a madman. We've shown you the videos, him and Shane Steiner training, and you get 15% off. What more do you need? And then sign up for AutoShip while you're at it. Okay, you sign up for AutoShip, and then you don't have to worry about reordering. It just automatically comes in the mail, and you get to pick how often you want your InfoWars Life products to show up in the mail. And with that, what were we going to end on today? I had it sitting right here in front of me, and then I moved it. Oh, just going to look you straight in the eye and tell you why you shouldn't fall for what mainstream media is telling you. Because these people are funded by giant pharmaceutical companies that want you to take stuff like Prozac and stuff that alters your brain chemistry. And we're offering stuff that doesn't alter your brain chemistry. It helps you work at a higher level. It gives you the things your body's lacking. Let me tell you, you're not lacking in Prozac, okay? That stuff even tells you in the fine print, it might make you want to go out and kill people or kill yourself. Might give you homicidal tendencies, okay? So remember that. The big pharmaceutical companies, they want to keep your mind imprisoned. We want to help free your mind here at InfoWars.com, which is why we're here every day, Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., and then on Sundays, 4 to 6. And then at night, 7 p.m. Central, the InfoWars Nightly News. Tonight will be Jakari Jackson. Hopefully, we'll have John Aquaviva on with him. Sorry you couldn't make it today. That's technology for you, folks. Sometimes you just got to roll with the punches. Stay tuned for more. InfoWars.com/show for the free streams.